This episode of Designers of the Worst is brought to you by the Florida Times bestseller, Wind, I Don't Get It, by Brian K. Athabasca, featuring such riveting chapters such as, If I Can't See Wind, Is It Even Real? And Did the Devil Make Wind or Break Wind? Pick it up for $24.99 on the back of any Shell or Husky gas stations and any reputable adult novelty stores. Brian would also like me to read the following disclaimer. Brian K. Athabasca is not a scientist nor a doctor, just a man who knows what's up. Let's start the show.
To Designers of the Worst, your new least favorite show of an exclusively visual medium cleverly brought to you in audio format.
Fuck this whole asshole up. You know what I'm saying? Open that asshole one more time. Open it again. Open that asshole again. Oh! Step out his ass. And leave that motherfucker wide open so he know you've been there.
That's all I gotta say. Good night, y'all.
What's the relevance to that for anything?
Relevance is I was looking for a relevant clip to play at the beginning of the show. Ended up just looking at Leon's greatest hits. And I said, well, this is better than anything I'm going to find. And yeah, so.
Is this the Bring the Ruckus?
No, that's
clip as well.
This is one when.
Oh, he's got to flip it on him.
Got to flip that motherfucker.
Yeah.
But no, this is when Larry went to the doctor and bumped into the skinhead. And he said some anti-Semitic stuff to him. And then he told Leon about it. And Leon was like, what'd you do to the motherfucker? He's like, I slunk out. And then so Leon right. Was to tell him to crawl inside his whole asshole and fuck his asshole up, leave garbage on the ground. And then we heard the end result, which is poetry in its own beautiful way.
It's good advice.
Yeah. So,
what's our karma at?
I wanted to bring that up.
It should be all time greatest.
It went up. So for those of you who did or didn't listen, the last episode when we were on Reddit fighting the urge to be mean, we actually had a few upvotes on some of our comments. Two people replied and was like, thank you, that's helpful. So we had So the guy that wanted to cut images into blocks for rearranging, and that was about the extent of it. Nothing there.
No action.
Throbster got a reply. Throbster got an upvote. We said, to be honest, the name is working just fine. Focus on a strong work mark instead of messing with visuals. Throbster. The guy said, aye, thank you for the feedback. And then a grammar-based smiley face. So that was one of our successes.
Was that count as...
Yeah, we got four
points?
Karma.
Four points?
Yeah, because we got two upvotes and one reply. So I think we got three karma points.
Oh.
So now I was curious if we were just going to be like, we've asked you to not participate anymore because you're snotty little dickheads. But the dead baby one got an upvote.
It had 2 points, including the one that you automatically get.
So yep. I'll take it.
One extra one.
And aside from that, we
there's
did
another
not
one
get a ton of traction.
There was another one with 2 points.
Was that the...
Learn to work well with a team and get more traditional art background. 2 points.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, the other one and then charging the keyboard. Oh, yeah. So three comment karma, one post karma. So yeah, we're up to four karma. I don't know what it means. We haven't been gifted any magical Reddit coins, so I'll check Reddit again and
we can redeem
in the Lunar New Year, and I'll see where we're at. But it was funny. I stopped caring about Reddit immediately when we were done.
Oh, yeah.
It's big, messy, gross, and it seems like people are asking kind of dumb questions they could find the answer to anywhere.
Right.
And then the same kind of people are answering the questions. Everyone thinks they're being helpful. But it's just kind of like a bunch of people going, no, after you, after you, after you. It's pointless politeness, and it has no spot in
which
a cynical society.
Which is exactly like art school. Very polite. constructive.
Yeah. Well, we would know.
That's all about ripping a new anus.
Gripping it, ripping it.
As John Daly would do to any anus.
Was John Daly and Adam Scott did that golf?
Well, he was a golfer. I don't know if he worked with anyone else to do some golf stuff.
There's a comedian named John Daly. Super funny.
Yes.
And then he always gets confused with the golfer. So him and Adam Scott, who was another golfer, made like a mockumentary. Yeah.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. But the golfer, John Daly, is that big fat guy.
Is he a drunk?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He's a drunk guy. Well, I don't know if he drinks as much anymore. He's kind of older, but in his heyday, he would like party all the time, smoke. And his slogan was grip it and rip it.
Grip and rip it. Yeah. And the funny thing is with that dude.
I still say it because it's that good.
I say it all the time because it's stupid and it delights me. But everyone knows like the Arnold Palmer, the iced tea and lemonade mixed together. The John Daly is that with vodka. He calls it the John Daly. <That's so laughs> it's like, yeah, it's pretty good. It's not getting me fucked up at all, which helps me golf. Yeah. So.
It should have a cigarette butt in it though at the same time.
Yeah.
Or like filtered through one. It's an anti-HEPA filter.
Yeah. That golf is, I've never played it. It looks boring.
I used to play. Yeah. Well, what I mean is I used to play once a year and never got any better and never got any worse. And I hated it. It was just dumb, but there was drinking involved. So that's what you just work. Do. It was the only kind of legal drinking and driving when you could just get drunk and drive around in a golf cart.
That is until you drive home from the golf course.
No, you make somebody else do that. Mm.
The person who's drank the least.
Or you sleep in the clubhouse.
Today, for those of you who are listening to this who are not in the room with us, we're going to be talking about the 2020 design trends that somebody said is a thing. I've never looked at one of these lists before. They're weird. I looked at the first two points. I didn't want to like go through the whole thing ahead of time. It really seems like they just kind of take what people are doing towards the end of the year and say, that's what it's going to be next year. Cause there's really,
100%.
I didn't see a shitload of science to it, but anyway, we're going to get into it and figure it out.
I have my own predictions list as well.
Yeah.
It's a mix of design and world. Fuck, that's no. Mix of design and.
What, no world.
Other.
Other.
Miscellaneous.
All right.
Design related predictions.
Oh. So I don't have any, like, when I started designing, I used to look at, like, design shit all day. Like, other people's work and like I had a like Caliber 10,000 and Surf Station and Design is Kinky. There are these like three sites that would just post like really cool design. Mm-hmm. And when I was starting, I didn't even know what was possible. So seeing all the shit was really cool, but I haven't looked at any of that stuff in like a decade or more.
It's most of the same stuff over and over.
Yeah. The last trend I saw was when Slack redesigned and then everybody ripped it off for a year.
Yeah.
And then Slack redesigned and everyone's like, oh, we have old Slack site. So I'm sure they're all looking like the new Slack one
now.
The
characters.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've been adverse to those forever because I've always thought like, what value do they add?
Nah.
They don't. Nobody. I get that they're trying to represent like a human form and it's an easy way to show diversity without needing people, mm-hmm. but they just don't add value to what you're trying to sell.
Yeah. I mean,
sometimes you just got to get to the point. Like, what is it? What are you selling?
And
how much?
And to be
how much?
AM. Oh, the European gentleman.
Yeah. If you go back to the Curb clip, there's a Borat, a suggested autoplay.
Oh, was there?
Yeah.
Oh, we might have to get into that later.
I think it was one of his old interviews.
But what was, fuck, what were we just talking about?
We were talking about Slack characters.
Slack, oh, yeah. So those characters are like nice and happy and they were really well done. Whoever illustrated them did a beautiful job. They were cool. But it's such a far leap from what Slack is. I hate using Slack. I find it ugly to look at, annoying to use. It's kind of like a little micro Reddit now that I've seen Reddit.
Yeah.
It's just people use it in the worst fucking way. And I've been calling people out on it at work to be like, hey, before you all post 30 animated GIFs after my comment, because you all are bored and you want to chirp in, can somebody please answer my question?
Yeah. Where I don't like, I get it as a, you know, a company communication tool over email. But what I don't like about it is that shit gets buried in it. And then you can't find what you originally wanted. And I know there's a bunch of other companies out there that are trying to figure that out and be like, it's the Slack alternative. And what it does is an actual like Reddit style where it's threads of like a topic. And you're like, okay, that kind of makes more sense. So I have a combination of like an ongoing conversation and then there's like threads, which is like, this is the topic we're talking about. Do not talk about anything else.
Yeah.
And then once it's done, you can close it or delete it and be like, be gone.
Well, the dumb thing is that that functionality currently exists in Slack, but nobody fucking uses it.
What, the channels?
Because you can reply to a post and it keeps it in a separate thread. So even if everybody piles on and starts like,
it does
jerking themselves off.
But those are still mixed in between single line conversations.
They are, but then you can look at your threads to see the conversations you've had. It's sloppy and I hate how people use it. What is a day? Wednesday? That's a day today. Monday I asked like genuine questions. I was like, hey, before I start this, I need to know these details. Who has them?
Yeah.
And then three comments about blah, 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 blah. It's like I literally had to say, before anybody posts any more dumb shit, can somebody please answer my question? And then I think two more joke comments and then it just was left.
Yeah.
And then later that day, it's like, let me try this one more time and posted it again. Then I got an answer. I'm so tired of like Slack is the alternative to email, but email is like, fuck, I got an email. Okay, I'll reply. Done. Slack is like, let's all communicate. It's like, we don't have to do this. We can just like, there are two channels at my work that I left because they're just too annoying.
Yeah. I don't know. Like I'm only on the necessity ones. I have to be on like projects and things like that. I don't know how people have time to be on other channels and contribute. Yeah. And I like, it's just distractions. And it gets to a point where those additional channels that aren't work related are basically taking Facebook or whatever off of that site and putting it in Slack. Cause now you're like, look at this comment, like fart.
Yeah.
And then it's just a distraction from what you're actually supposed to do.
Yeah.
So I don't join any of those. I have a strict no join policy.
No,
for myself.
When I started at where I'm at right now, they just like automatically add you to like random and general and all this stuff. Yeah. And then over time it's like remove, because, and I am going to single out developers, is that they tend to have a much longer chat with like way more like Lord of the Rings references and shit like that. Not to say that it's longer than the designers ones. The designer ones are way more like GIF heavy and like weird picture heavy and all that. They're equally long and equally pointless and annoying, but they are two very different streams of like waste of time bullshit.
Yeah.
So when I reply to people and I say, sure, because yep, got it. And then there's 12 like animated GIFs of like Pee Wee Herman and fucking Barney the dinosaur like dancing together. It's like, why are we doing this? And then like I had to turn off all notifications because you'll get notified 85 times a day that like Johnny posted a picture of fucking Wesley Snipes like raising an eyebrow. Like I don't, why are you fucking bothering me with
you
this?
You can also collapse all attachments so that none of them show expanded.
Oh, that'd be good.
That's what I've done. And then so you only open like what you need to see.
Yeah, that'd be good. But I just have to get people to actually talk on there rather than just like jabber jibber jaw and like waste all fucking time.
It was funny. I forgot to check my email today. I just didn't do it. Yeah. And then at the end of the day, it's like, oh, I gotta send this guy an email with some prototype stuff. totally forgot that I hadn't opened it all day. And I opened it, I was like, I didn't miss anything. Great.
Yep.
Send it, closed it. It's like, that's, it was just filled with like, here's your Black Friday sale. It's like, oh,
yeah.
I got to unsubscribe from these.
But it's like when I didn't check my email for 6 weeks, like a few months ago, or yeah. I didn't check for like 2 months or whatever it was. Nothing. Fucking Netflix is like, here's a show you might like. Two people are like, hey, sorry, it took me so long to get back to you. Do you still want to do that project? And I just didn't respond to them because I gave them criteria, being like, yes, I will do this project. You give half up front. You have to give me all the materials within the next 7 days and blah, blah, blah. Because this is my window of availability. Saying your failure to comply with any of this shit will get you nothing. Yeah. And then they waited 6 days and they said, sure, can you get started right away? And I didn't even reply. I was like, fucking, like how, like it was the most clear I've ever been with what I need from somebody and when, or else they get nothing.
What's,
and they're just like, yeah, whatever. While you're on vacation, would you mind just handling that? I was like, sure, shit, I'm not going to ever. And, and I assume they found other people to do it. But like one of them was one of the breweries I've been working with forever. And just the last like few interactions, last few interactions over the past like year and a bit, it's just everything takes forever. And then it leaves me, it was like, now I have 2 days to make it. But the whole process up front, they're just not efficient. Mm-hmm. And I was kind of doing it as like a nice thing to maintain the brand, because I didn't want to see it take a nosedive. But fuck it. Like I don't have time to wait around for people to get their shit together anymore. So I just don't. And then all of a sudden they just stop messaging me, and then life gets a little easier.
It's an ongoing thing that I haven't figured out how to solve it yet, but companies and whoever's involved with, say, like a project from a company standpoint, if they're doing such sort of like a rebrand or anything new, they have no concept of how long it takes to get assets. You need to hire a photographer. You need to hire somebody to create this, whatever. Yep. And like even photography, like you have to book a photographer that you want to use that can achieve the style that you've set.
You have to art direct it.
You have beforehand. To art direct it. You have to give a shot list. Then they have to edit it.
Gather props and everything you need for the day.
And it's not just like, oh, we'll take some photos with our phones. Yep. And everything else that comes with it, I'm having a hard time like figuring out where that easy point is to help explain, like to understand, like it's not a simple process and it takes time. So anytime that we're working with a client that it's like, oh, we're just in the middle of the rebrand, we'll be done by this date, it's like, add like a month or two to that. And I've said that on multiple projects. And now people are like, oh yeah, we've considered that. And now the timing is right because we added the extra time. Yeah. Funny enough, I don't know if it's the same brewery you're referring to, but
were they with the beer?
Yes. Chatting with a coworker today, and he was mentioning that there was a brewery in town that he really liked the labels way back when. He's like, I don't know what happened, but their new labels are so boring and like they're ugly. And so I gave him the lowdown, and he's like, oh, that makes sense.
And he's alluding to Category 12 Brewing.
Bingo.
Hey, those are the ones I did.
Yeah.
The ones that they like. But yeah, the new ones are, it's like they've taken it into their own hands or something.
They've
tons of drop shadow and
they've
weird.
They've treated the brand outside of how it was originally created.
Yeah.
And the direction of those cans is just like, it's poor. The beer's good, but the cans.
It looks like it should be half as much as it is because it's
looks like
visually it looks like shit.
Kmart beer.
Yeah, yeah, and that was essentially the what Leon was talking about at the beginning of this episode. Once I stopped working with them and they started taking their own brand, they crawled inside the asshole and ripped it wide open and just let themselves know that they were there. So, but yeah, it's always hard when you put in a ton of time and thought and often a lot of free work, like with certain clients who we weren't just talking about, wink, wink. Some clients receive upwards of $10,000 worth of free work over the course of 2 or more years because, you know, places starting out, the nice people, you want to help them. And then it just goes on and on and on. And then they expect it, which is my fault for trying to maintain the brand so hard that I was doing stuff for next to nothing.
Yeah.
And then they are surprised when, and rightfully so, they're surprised when it's more, when you send them a fresh estimate. They're like, why is this like four times as much? It's like, because you have money now. They're like, well, we don't want to pay this. And this situation didn't happen with that client. I've had that happen with other people. But yeah, it's just, over the past like 3 years, just really gotten over, like just fucking my life over to help somebody who really doesn't care how it comes out. Cause they would, if they could work Illustrator or Photoshop or draw or do whatever, they would gladly do it themselves. They don't have to deal with other people. Mm-hmm. So best I can do is like, I set you off on the right path. I'm going to say goodbye. Once you start realizing I'm more expensive than I'm worth as a production designer, worth it in the initial stages with all the, you know, ideation and research and concepts and all the like big picture shit. But then when it gets to like, we need a tent card for a pub, it's like, all right, that'll be $500. They're like, why? I was like, because there's nobody else other than me. If I had a junior designer, it would be $250, but I don't. So my time has one value, and then it just kind of, whatever.
Especially outside of work.
Yeah. Oh, but
so my time is worth more outside of work, so I charge more.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. Like I've taken to charging a minimum for anything outside work, even if it's like 1 hour. I charge 3 hours just because it's going to take me an hour to finally get around to doing it. I'm going to like read CNN. I'm going to talk to the kids. I'm going to like fucking make coffee or something and just walk around and like procrastinate for an hour. Then it'll take me an hour to do the work. And then it'll take me an hour afterwards to check the email every 5 minutes to be like, did they get back to me? Did they get back to me? Because I just want it gone and done so I can bill. Mm-hmm. So I bill for that time. But speaking of beer, brewery, I did 3 brand new can designs for last year. Finally came out the Canterbury beer.
Right.
So it's Pacific Western Brewing. It's the oldest craft brewery in British Columbia. They started in like 1957 or something. And the Canterbury beer is like kind of this ghetto-esque British beer. Like it wasn't very expensive and it came in a 12-pack and it looked fine. And it looked very British, but they wanted to up their game, you know, and touch up the recipe and charge more for it. So then I did 3 cans last year. And they finally came out. Ryan, my lady, managed to find 2 of them. They came out pretty well, the print job. But the fun thing, because it was named after the Canterbury Cathedral, so I researched all about the cathedral, and 5 of their archbishops were murdered since its inception. And it was like the birthplace of like the Protestant church or something like that. Mm-hmm. So each can is an homage to one of the archbishops that were murdered. And I pitched the idea just wondering like, I don't know if they're going to like this angle.
Yeah.
And they fucking loved it.
Right.
So like, sweet. 5 guys murdered, so we can do 5 beers. Like they want to do 3 initially, then they might want to do some more later. So one of the archbishops was kidnapped by Vikings. The Vikings told his village and his church, like, give us, it was like 300 fucking pickle shekels or whatever they were trading back then. And the archbishop was like, no, they're very poor people. You can't ask them for money. Because I would rather they had it to feed themselves and to keep the church going, so you can just keep me. Mm-hmm. And then the Viking king was so pissed that one night at dinner, they were having Viking meal, as is tradition, and they took a bison bone, because they were eating a bison or something, or maybe, whatever. Large.
Buffalo, bison.
Large critter, whatever was in Europe at that time.
Iguana.
Iguana. Marina iguana. And then they took one of like the leg bones. And they were drunk and decided just to beat the archbishop to death because they didn't get any money. And that's how he died. He got beaten to death with a dinner bone.
Probably like a femur bone.
Yeah. So
are those just in the tall cans or are they?
Yeah.
Are they sold as singles?
No. Whatever Guinness comes in, 4 packs. Yeah. They wanted to mimic like the Guinness price point and shelving and stuff. So yeah, so those finally came out. So it was nice to see, because it had been a while since it happened. Kind of, and
you
then
must have forgotten about them.
I didn't, because the company I was working with at the time, I did like 99% of the work, and then I left. And then like months later, like, yeah, cool. Yeah, we haven't heard from them forever. They had a couple like minor changes that they wanted done to the labels, so we did those. And we don't know when they're coming out. And then I was like, oh no, somebody touched my shit. Because all the lettering, everything on it was hand done.
Right.
There was nothing was typed on it. So I was like, did you fucking put like a font in that? And I looked at it and I can't see what they changed. So whatever it was minor. I think maybe it was color or something like that. But right. Yeah, so if you're drinking beer in the world around here, if you see the Canterbury
is it on their site?
That is a great question. It is on their site, but they have like really terrible photos of it. So, just like bad lighting, it's like really dark and really bright at the same time.
Yeah.
So, I can show you later though, the actual things, but yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's fun for after the show for everybody. Speaking of things, products. This is a transition. I saw this. I consider it design because it's design products, but they're taking a stand for pollution. So anti-hero skateboards, which Grant Taylor, the skater of your shoes that you just got, hell of a wheelie boarder, man. Them and Gnar Hunters, which is a clothing company by Alyssa Steamer and some other people, other skaters, they came out with this collection. Kind of the symbol, I think it's Todd Francis did the art. He does lots of the anti-hero stuff. It's a seagull with like a six-pack ring around its neck. So what they're doing kind of as like a pilot project with this shit, they did boards, shirts, hoodies, towels, and I think they had dog koozie. Beer preserver for the pigeon of the sea. Great. Yeah. So what they're doing with this project is everything here, they are not wrapping any of it in plastic when they ship it.
How's it shipped then?
As it would normally be shipped. Like boards are normally shrink wrapped. Mm-hmm. So the graphics don't scratch, but they're just like, there's too much plastic. If your board,
using like structured cardboard at least?
There's got to be some kind of divider between the graphics.
When you, even IKEA now, if you buy anything from them, they've gotten rid of all their styrofoam and it's just rigid cardboard between things. So it's just cardboard.
Which is great.
Yeah.
So anti-hero, kind of the fuck off dirt bags of skateboarding, one of the best teams, they said, as sort of experiment, we're not packaging anything in plastic. The boards too, because there's enough fucking plastic, meaningless, useless plastic in the world. So it's a pilot project. They're going to ship out all this clothing and the boards and all that with no plastic and see how it goes. Hmm. The weird thing is that people want their boards to arrive pristine, like in pristine condition, mm-hmm. so they can then take it outside and rub the shit out of it against a curb.
Weird.
So if it has a scratch on it, guess what? If it's the only one it's ever going to get, then you just don't buy it because you're not riding it.
Yeah.
But it's going to get fucked up anyway, and you're saving plastic. And if anti-hero says it's cool, then it's guaranteed to be cool.
So this is really interesting because I won't, don't close this link.
Yeah.
Because it fits in nicely with my predictions. Very much so.
We're going to dock it.
Yeah, we sure are.
Speaking,
that's really cool, though. I like the products themselves.
Yeah. Yeah, they're awesome. Awesome art. Good companies, and they're doing it for good reason. Another skate related thing that I just happened to find because I'm on Thrasher every day. So if you've never read a Thrasher, in the first like 10 pages, they have something called mail drop where people draw on envelopes, graphics specific for Thrasher. And then they write like, I think it's like T. Eddie or whatever. He replies to the questions in the mail.
Mm-hmm.
And it's always like long, like 200 word questions. And then T. Eddie will just reply, fuck it. And that's it. That's the reply. That's great. I don't read the questions. I only read the replies. But anyway, every month they'll feature like five of the best envelopes they received that month. And then they have envelope of the month. So every month there's the best envelope. So they've been doing this for how long?
38 years.
It
kind of reminds me of something I feel like this was something similar that maybe Mad Magazine or Cracked would do, like features stuff that people would draw in of like Alfred E. Newman, maybe.
Yeah.
It's definitely got like something's clicking in my brain. Not that I've seen envelopes, but.
Yeah. So what they did is they compiled, they said there's thousands of them in here. Anyway, Thrasher put together a book called Mail Drop 38 Years of Envelope Art. And it's just their favorite or the best or whatever envelopes over the years. And it's like a coffee table book. Like I have one on like skateboard stickers that like I look at all the, actually I lent it to Good News Skate Shop so they could let people check it out. So yeah.
So is this for sale?
Yeah. Yeah. It looks awesome. So if you go to worstdesignshow.com, we put up all the links and everything to everything, but some of them are like pretty terrible. Some of them are pretty incredible. A lot of them are from dudes in prison where they'll like draw themselves. Oh, that's a nice one. Laying like in their prison bunk, dreaming about skateboarding. Like I've seen it so many times in Thrasher and they have one of them in here, but like this whole article where they're just promoting it has like 100 different envelopes. So they have,
how long is this page?
It is plenty. Let's see what the newest ones. But yeah, so it's like this one was from October, I think. There's like kind of a little scarecrow guy, but it's from Comal County Jail inmate mail. But that dude can draw. So yeah, if you like just like grimy lo-fi art that is confined to the bounds of an envelope and it's just like awesome shit, terrible shit, funny shit, whatever.
And it definitely has that, not in all of them, but a majority of them have that like high school doodling vibe.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Where you just draw whatever on shit. That character there, the yellow character.
This? Oh yeah, that.
I drew that character at some point in high school.
That's kind of like a...
And I don't know what it is.
Pencil-headed robot guy.
It's weird.
But yeah, so I know, I found it looking on Thrasher and I was looking on their store and saw it just got released. But I think I'm going to pick it up because I love shit like this. Because none of it's perfect. It's all just whatever. Oh, on the cover too. It's a rad, rad drawing and painting of like zombie Batman doing like a 5-0 grind on a pool and all the copings crumbling off and all like, it's just a cool,
but I like the barf comics in the background.
Yeah.
Richmond, Virginia.
Yeah, exactly. So like some people get real creative with like their address and the typography. Other people just kind of like whatever.
Some people really just explore the space.
Oh, really feel it, girl.
Some people don't think about it.
No.
Fuck it up really easy.
But yeah.
Is that a take? Go back up. I think that's a, like a takeoff of the Snoop Dogg Doggy Pound,
no, or Doggy Pound Style
album cover. It looks like the same brick color. And,
yeah.
Well, that's fun.
Yeah. So yeah, that is fun. Big design news this week for apparently everybody. Cybertruck.
Uh huh.
I like it quite a bit.
So, okay, you go first.
I think
because we're both gonna come on it.
I think it's great because all of the Teslas thus far, and if you haven't seen Cybertruck, go to tesla.com/Cybertruck and look at the futuristic Mad Maxi.
I mean, to be honest, I'm pretty sure everyone's seen Cybertruck. Yeah.
But if you haven't seen it, go check it out. The reason I really like it is because every Tesla that's come thus far, I think it's weird they don't have a grill because they're structured like a regular car. I think they look weird.
Right.
Cybertruck said, we are not being anything that has been before. So I didn't miss the grill on this because the whole thing looks like a spaceship.
Well, when I first saw it, I was like, oh, that's really interesting. I'm not sure what I to think about it.
Yeah.
But then, you know, I watched a couple videos of people just talking about it. And one point that really stood out, or one opinion that really stood out to me, was that if you look at the landscape of vehicles and trucks specifically,
yeah,
they all look the same.
Yep.
It's a truck. You get it. Go on. They all look the same. The interiors look the same. It's just the same old, same old. And I think they had to do this to really stand out because there are a number of competitors coming into the space. Amazon is invested in one company. And then there's another one I found that makes like these Mercedes looking kind of square like truck things.
Yeah.
But they look like trucks.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, but this doesn't look like a truck, but it is a truck.
Yeah.
And the other thing too is that it's $150 to reserve it,
which is gnarly.
And there's 250,000 reservations now, but so even the
did you work out how much that was? It's over $10 billion in pre-sales. Well, like if they sold every one, yes, it'll be $10 billion.
But even the highest end version of this is still cheaper than a brand new like diesel Cummins Dodge, which is at like $90,000 to $100,000 to start.
And it's just they're giant nasty
things,
and like this has more space in the bed. It accelerates faster. It can tow more.
It seats in terms of vehicles that are just cool. It's like it's cool.
Like the only thing that it lacks in as compared to like the major competitors is range. It can go over 300 miles. Other ones go like 500 something. So there is like if you're hauling shit a long way,
for sure.
But then on the other hand, it has its like the entire dash is like a marble counter and a 17-inch iPad.
Yeah.
And that's the whole thing.
That back cover is solar panels. Well, you can get it solar panels. They said they're going to make it an option.
Yeah. And then they have like the camping expansion on it and stuff, which is awesome.
I know that 200,000 plus people aren't going to be buying it, but they're going to obviously refund them at that point. But I think there's going to be a lot of these on the road by 2022, I think, when they come out. But the thing that I wonder is, like, in those 2 years, how much is the tech going to change that this isn't going to be the new thing anymore in 2 years?
But in 2 years, we'll be introducing the new thing, which will come out in 2 years.
What really?
Like, everyone's still racing to catch up to these guys, and I don't know who's going to be able to jump in like midstream, like especially after Cybertruck, which even has a rad logo. Well, like for a car, it's awesome.
Ford showed their all electric Mustang.
That SUV.
An actual Mustang car.
And no, they made a Mustang SUV.
Oh, I know.
It's disgusting.
But the interior and like the console, the whole like touchscreen, right? I watched a video of it and it was embarrassing. It was so bad. It's like, come on, just throw an iPad. Who cares?
Yeah.
What I'm waiting for is like, this is cool. The truck's cool. They showed an ATV out of nowhere.
Yeah, they invented the ATV electric,
but
they threw in the back.
But at the end of the day, this is all still, if you're a single person, you're taking up a lot of space on the road.
Yeah.
So I'm waiting to see like who's going to come up. Like I know Harley just came out with their electric motorcycle.
Yeah.
But that is where people should be focusing on like the single 1 to 2 people vehicles.
And yeah.
There's
a company huge that has 1-person electric vehicle. I saw one in Vancouver a while back, and then the DoubleTree Hotel downtown here, they have one for like their guests, but it's like straight up just a cockpit, and I think it's 2 wheels in the front, 1 in the back.
Right.
Like it looks very like an old kind of Italian car. They had like the weird three-wheeled ones, but it's like they stretched it out and just made it a cockpit, and it's weird, but yeah, for 1 person, it's rad.
Volkswagen's got they've shown off their new lineup of all electric vehicles. They've redesigned them all. They look nice, but nothing's been as stunning as a Cybertruck. It's in terms of like that showing up, that will get attention no matter what.
What I'm curious about is what it's going to look like when they actually make it.
How much of it's going to change?
Because those, like some of the cooler aspects of it are like the hard points, but legally they can't have those on the road because those become people murderers. Like the reason hood ornaments don't exist anymore is because people were getting impaled on them.
Where's the windshield wipers too?
Where's the side view mirrors?
The indicators.
All this kind of stuff. They're saying as it stands, this isn't legal, but they're also saying like, yeah, but we're not fucking selling it yet.
Yeah.
So what they're saying, and the rear view mirror.
It's a screen
with a camera. And they're saying that by the time that this is on the road, the federal government may pass rear view cameras as a legal option for a rear view mirror.
Interesting.
So I don't know what that means for the side views, if everything's going to be digital.
Yeah, I mean, it'd be interesting to be able to drive down the road and not be blinded by at night and not be blinded by other people's lights.
Yeah, like I'm wondering if there's going to be like a screen on either side of like the steering wheel. And the steering wheel's cool too. It's just that little, almost like little rectangular thing.
I hope they change that. That's ridiculous.
I like it. but I'm wondering if the side view mirrors will be little cameras, like little screens on either side of the steering wheel to be like, oh, I'm good there, I'm good there. And if it can give more of like a fisheye view so you can get like no blind spot. Mm-hmm. If they can legalize cameras and screens as an alternative to mirrors, I'm curious what their solution is going to be.
That or they put the mirror screens closer, like actually on the windshield. So you don't have to actually like, look. Oh,
that'd be cool.
So you wouldn't
like
need
Minority
it.
Report.
Yeah. So the screens are cameras that are pointed backwards. And then you just look ahead to see who's beside you instead of having to turn, making it safer.
Pre-crime.
Yeah.
So design-wise, I think Cybertruck is gnarly. It's what the Lord and like the Lord of the Land in like a Mad Max movie would drive. Everyone else has rusted pieces of shit, and he has this weird like aluminum brushed, clear coated like fuck you machine.
Yeah,
and that's why I like it.
And then I'm gonna say, don't close this tab because this falls into my predictions as well.
Waka waka. Last big thing, which I think is delightful. So. The Dallas Mavericks, what is it, like a bunch of episodes ago, we did all the NBA logo reviews. I want to do that again right after the Super Bowl and review all of the football logos, because what better time than when nobody's watching football? Or we can do the baseball ones now.
We can do the NFL and the CFL in one.
Yeah, I mean,
if we want to.
The CFL has two teams named the Blue Bombers.
No, two teams.
Rough Riders.
Yeah.
And there's 10 teams in the league or something. And
I think there's eight now.
No one's more terrifying than the Montreal Alouettes. Whoa. So anyway, we talked a lot about basketball logos. We talked about jerseys and kind of like eras and shit. And like we also spoke at some point about like the team, like the city edition jerseys.
Briefly, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's because the Clippers was the spur of that.
There was that one, but like the Miami Heat has like the Miami Vice colored ones and stuff, and they're rad. Mm-hmm. Some of them are gross. The Dallas Mavericks just unleashed theirs, and it's the worst goddamn, like, it'd be like if my mom was like, look, I made a cool graffiti shirt for you and wrote like Mavs on it. It's the worst graffiti lettering I've ever seen. It's horrifying. I don't understand, like, I just don't get why they thought it was cool. Like, it's the jersey is a, from top to bottom is a light to dark blue gradient with like day glow green shit all over it. And then it says Mavs in the laziest, worst graffiti type I've ever seen. Like, it's Dallas. It's a big ass city. It doesn't rain there very much. I imagine there's a shitload of people tagging. Just put out a call. We are looking for graffiti artists to design the logo for our new city edition jersey. Come down, bring your cans, and write some shit on the wall, and we'll pick a winner, and you can be it. This is fucking horrible.
There's a video on the tweet above, and there's something at the end of it that was... Oh, boy. Oh, boy.
Oh, it's go time. Oh. City edition that, launch party.
That type is horrendous.
But it's a font.
It is, and funny enough, it.
Is it a defont? I have a feeling it's a defont font.
Like the A is very similar to what they used in the Mavs.
Yeah.
Like I feel like it is just. Somebody found graffiti font and went with that. And I don't even know what that other type is below it, but.
No, holy shit, that's terrible. Yeah, but it's just another example of like, why can't NBA teams get anything right?
But like, you're better off putting like Bojack Horseman on the jersey.
Or Bo Jackson.
It's really bad. Does every team have a street or a city jersey?
Yeah, they all have city edition jerseys.
Okay, well, now I need to see. I need to see them. Maybe we'll take a break while we bring them, while we find them.
Yeah. Yeah, we can check them out. I know the podcast, the Flagrant Ones, did a review of all the city edition jerseys.
Yeah.
And some of them are cool. Some of them are just absolute, of cat dicks.
Who's Rip City?
That's Portland.
Oh, Portland.
Which I thought was kind of a cool, that's like a shout out to like their old typeface and stuff, like the old Trailblazers one.
Right.
But Rip City is a pretty cool name. And they went with like an off-white instead of a white. It has an old vibe. But anyway, yeah, we can go through this shit at some point.
These are just
stunning.
Hits and misses.
Ooh, I wish I was from Cream City. Milwaukee Bucks. Cream City. Jesus Christ. So yeah, maybe we'll, even though the Flagrant Ones did this, maybe we'll do this again too. Because every year they come out with new ones too. And some years they like completely change it up. Some years they just like change a color. Like the San Antonio Spurs, I know it's been this fucking horrifying camouflage.
Sacktown.
That like digital camouflage for a little while. Sacktown, Cream City, NOLA.
What is the, New Orleans. The Wizards? I thought those were the Clippers.
It is a
No, that's Washington. The Wizards. That can't be right.
It says DC. I thought it was CLC.
Yeah.
All right. This is going to be a thing for a thing at another time, and that is going to be great. To wrap it up, I want to announce this will be the last Jerry King for a while.
Yeah.
I think we're hitting maximum capacity with Jerry King.
I think so.
I think I picked a good one for a farewell. In the new year, because this show is coming out December 5th, and then we have a 19th, and then there's a December 2nd, or January 2nd, I think is the next one. So in the new year, I want a whole new thing that we can yell at every week.
Great.
They're easy enough to find because everyone's kind of a dickhead in this industry. That is putting out the like, hey, look how clever and funny this is. It never is.
At some point we still have to live up to the name of the show.
I think we do that episode after episode.
I don't know.
Let's just say our inbox isn't like blowing up with people wanting to be our friends.
Have we ever received an email?
No, we haven't.
Awesome.
Yeah. So that's designersaretheworst@gmail.com. And I actually sent myself an email from another account to make sure it was working. 10-4, that is 100% functional. We have received no correspondence from Ireland.
Limerick,
Ireland. And they stopped listening to the show. I think they got annoyed that we kept talking to them.
Or the VPN changed.
Yeah, or maybe that branch of the library shut down.
It's true.
And now they have a lot of catching up to do. But anyway, for a final Jerry King, it's not like I picked a special one. They're all horrifying. At King Cartoons on Twitter, you can be one of his 114 followers. If you get in early, you can be one of the first 1,000 followers, and he's been online for, I don't know, 45 years. So how it works, for the last time, Marcus is going to paint you a word picture of what the hell he's seen. I've removed all the text, so we have no idea what they're saying. And then we're going to guess what they're saying. I'm not going to guess because I know what it is. Take it away,
okay,
big honcho.
So it's, once again, it's two people in a round room. I think he just lives in a circle.
Like the bow of a tugboat?
Yeah. And it's a man and a woman, and they're standing in front of a window. They're on the inside of the window.
You'd hope so.
And the window is smashed. There's glass on the floor, and the lady's holding what I believe to be a rock with a note on it. But at this point, I could be wrong.
What's going on with the floor?
The bigger question is, if you look at her arm and consider where her elbow ends at her hip, then her actual length of her arm reaches her shin.
Yeah, like everybody else, our elbow goes down to the tip of our penis.
Well,
and then there's a half a other arm attached to that.
Because you can't see the other arm, he just doubled up the one arm.
Oh, I guess
that's what happens.
It's a two for one.
Yeah. So the floor is also looks like a hardwood floor, but there's two different images used, and I don't know why, because they're two different perspectives. It's I've stopped questioning it. The curtains have a floral pattern. Don't care. So I'm going to guess that she's looking at a note, but she hasn't opened it yet. So she couldn't be reading it, but maybe it's something along the lines of client has another change request last minute.
That's pretty good. See, that's another thing. You're getting very good at these. It's getting harder to surprise you. It's not impossible because it's fucking horrifying.
So that's what I think.
All right. So also let's take a note of where her butt is. It's just like almost mid-back.
Is that
it's higher than her elbow. Let's put it that way. So if you're listening, just stand up and see where your elbow aligns with your butt and just then flip them. And that's how this young lady's built.
If I didn't know any better, on her bangs, did Jerry write cuck?
Or is it a very subtle, maybe he's Australian. I think it's cunt.
Might be. No, it's definitely a CT. Or CK. Interesting.
Louis CK. He's a Louis CK apologist.
Yeah. In her bangs says, I cuck. Oh, Jerry, we're on to you.
Well, that's why the guy behind him. Conspiracy theories. He looks just generally terrified all the time.
Anyways, what is the award-winning caption?
But drum roll. Nice.
It's your first engagement in social media for years. What? it's your first engagement in social media for years. That reads like I'm having a stroke. Am I missing something of how it's written? It's your first engagement in social media for years. Should it be in years? I think the 4 years is really throwing me off.
Four more years. But it's your first. So if you get a notification on anything that you use in social media, you say, good news, fellows, I've received an engagement.
There's no way I can rationalize the caption with the content.
It's your first engagement in social media 4 years.
I mean, if we're killing off the segment, I'm glad it was this one because this is the worst caption I've read out of all of these.
Like with the other ones, even with this one, you know what he's going for, but how is he so bad at talking? Doesn't he write this shit and then like, come here, daughter, let me read you Jerry's newest shit, and then be like, dad, that doesn't make any sense. Like, people don't talk like that. They're like, no, but it is your first engagement in social media 4 years. Nobody's ever said that sentence before.
I can't make ass or tail of it.
No. So going out on a low note, started on a low note. And Jerry, the master of low notes.
Should our next episode be the apology tour for doing these?
Yeah. And we'll just, we could just spend an hour looking at some of the 1200 we didn't look at. During the course, I think it's been like 15 or 12 episodes we've been looking at Jerry King shit. Oh, it's also episode 25. Hopefully we get our contract renewed.
Yeah. Oh, we should just pick like our top three favorites.
Yeah.
From like the archives and then just present them to each other.
Just
show each other our Jerry Kings.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
With the caption, like right off the bat.
Yeah. Yeah. I could post them all with all the like make a game that like a PDF or whatever that people can be like just in their office just fucking what do you think this is and spend 8 minutes hating being alive and then go back to work just like if nothing else you'll feel better about your ability because you're not as bad at Jerry King at anything likely.
Do you know what if you had the time desire to do so and knowledge you should make a Jerry King generator where it just takes the art or the content, I'm not going to call it art, and it mixes it with a random caption that he's written. And it would make as much sense.
Yeah. What we could do is create a competing persona named Carrie Jing and make our own cartoons.
See how fast we can beat his follower count.
I bet I'll get halfway through one before I'm like, I don't want to do this every week. I don't know how he does this with his life.
But I will take that bet.
Yep. Well, you've already won because I stopped wanting to do it right away once I realized it would actually take me doing stuff. So, Jerry King, You've served us well. You're baffling. I don't understand. But
there's no computer in this one.
Well, we don't know. He's not great at drawing computers. She could be holding a computer. Like, it's not a rock with a piece of paper tied to it. So, sadly, Jerry King, this is your last engagement in Designers Are the Worst 4 years. And we thank you for your service. And when we come back, we're going to be talking about design trends for next year, because who can predict them and who cares?
Ejaculate.
Ejaculate.
Not ejaculate, ejaculate.
Ejaculate.
Come, stain. Come.
Come,
stain.
What kind of cum was it, first of all?
What do you mean, what kind of cum? Cum's cum.
Cum is not cum, Larry.
Cum's cum.
Well, it couldn't have been mine. Know why? Because I gets mine, Larry. I brings the ruckus to the ladies.
Welcome back, darlings. We've missed you. We've clapped our hands and we've missed you. Today, on this very special 25th episode.
25th anniversary of episodes.
This is our Jubilee. Jubilee episode. We're going to be talking about what other people think the graphic design trends of 2020 are going to be. Now, I don't know what any of these things are. Marks and I were talking during the break. How I used to look at a lot of inspiration and like a lot of other designers' work and all that kind of stuff. I found it would just cloud the shit that I would make and it would get in the way. So like 10, 12, something, 15 years ago, I just stopped looking at everything. And then I just try and dive in so far with a client and then make them something I feel is correct for them. Not knowing if it's last year's trend or next year's trend or no trend at all. So all of this, I'm going to find real interesting, because how the hell did they even know? Like, did they just watch what people are, like, are they just watching Dribbble and, like, looking at the Webbies to be like, this is what's cool now, or Behance, like, what gets the most votes?
It's
or
probably that. And I think some of them will extend, or they'll try to extend over 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
So it kind of just is the same thing you'll see year after year.
So, first of all, what's the worst design trend right now? Like, I don't know what they are.
I mean, it really depends
on best.
It really depends on where you look.
Yeah. It's hard to, for me, it's hard to consider a trend to be like, this is one of the best trends. Like, if a trend is like legibility or like color harmony or something, then that, but it's always like they call it trends, but it tends to be specific graphic styles.
Right. I think the biggest trend right now, wait, what was the question? What the biggest one is or what the worst?
The biggest one right now.
I think there's two. One is in, like, if you look at a website within a grid, it's like staggering things that aren't really uniform and aligned.
Yeah,
is very trendy right now, and a lot of circles,
a lot of circles,
like,
are back.
Outline circles and shit like that. I also equate that to a lot of the design tools can't do anything but a circle.
Yeah,
like they can't do advanced polygons. Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah,
I know that's not true, but that seems to be a thing. A lot of like scroll interaction, which does other shit. It's neat for 2 seconds, but when the majority of traffic's on the phone, it doesn't matter.
Well, that's the
thing. Hover states don't matter.
No.
Like, and I don't know why people put effort into it unless it's your own site and you have hours to spend on it.
Yeah.
The other trend is the, and I just wrote it down, is the, I don't think it's a term, but the Cooper font era.
Oh, like the chubby retro font?
Yeah. So like, Giovanni, the yogurt company.
Giovanni Ribisi.
Giovanni Ribisi.
Called the one man yogurt
for
company.
For all your Italian yogurt
that
needs.
Dude produces. And he's a Scientologist.
I don't want to say that they were the first, but that I feel like they were one of the first companies who they rebranded and they used like a Cooper style font. It was a custom.
Yeah.
And then I've started to see it more and more since that time of choices. And so now it's to the point where you can see a brand and you're like, oh, I know exactly what type they used.
Yeah, I've seen it in some skating, like Nike use it for a video with featuring all their female skaters. Yeah. It's a good video. It's called Gizmo. Like I've seen it here and there, and it.
Look up Recoleta. So R-E-C-E-L Recoleta. Recoleta. Just write it and then font. It's one of those suggestions, but yeah, sure. So this is a big one right now that a lot of people are using.
It's nice.
It is, and this is where it's becoming way more common, and it's definitely a trend because it falls, I consider, under the Cooper
family. Chubby Serif.
Yeah.
Kind of like a throwback 70s kind of thing. And
yeah.
Like often when... For me, these typefaces really, really work when they're kind of left on their own more. When you start, like, the example we're looking at right now, the Recoleta on my fonts, the first panel is they just have, like, a big kind of beige rectangle with Recoleta in there and some little type in the corners. And, like, that type needs to be the star because when you put it over, in the example they have to the right where they put it on, like, a fake magazine cover, it looks like a cheap, shitty typeface. It says like King Mag and it's weirdly underlined and it's over top of a photo on a blue background. And I think that looks cheap, like an in-flight magazine. But then the one beside it, it's like yellow. It says Welcome to the New World, yellow with black type. And that's all it is, really. I think that's where it shines.
Mm-hmm.
Typefaces like that, I'm always so careful to use because they make so much of a statement on their own. That you can easily fucking, like, hey, I was going to say you can put a hat on a hat, then a picture of a goddamn hat showed up. 25th episode of Magic. Jubilee! So old school type?
Specifically the new old school.
Yeah.
That's a trend for this year that I would see quite often. People are really into transitions.
Yeah.
But once again, I...
Not the glasses.
No, the glasses, the
ones that are always medium gray because there's always some light somewhere.
There was somebody I went to high school with that had them, and we just made fun of them. I feel bad.
They all look like Columbine shooters because they just have like half gray. I was either just outside or I'm just about to go outside.
Yeah, but I'm prepared no matter what. Now, I'm not saying that this is a bad trend. It's kind of a step in a nice direction because a lot of fashion brands have killed off any of their original type and their original branding and gone just for straight serifs.
Yeah.
And be like, it doesn't matter. They all look the same now. And it's really interesting that they've gone in this opposite direction of not trying to stand out in the sea of things. But yeah, hover state transitions and then like page transitions, it all just adds bloat to your phone.
Yeah. It's doing push-ups in the mirror, and I've always hated it just because that can just be for the designer.
Yeah.
Like it doesn't, like if it helps and it like helps convert and make money, whatever, fucking go nuts. But it's just like, no, it's very tasteful animation. like I work with somebody years ago who loved that shit.
Yeah.
And I just could never, like, whenever they spent like 2 days just tweaking the animation, it drove me nuts. Cause like, dude, this is not making any fucking money.
Mm-hmm.
Like you are like doing Hulk Hogan poses in the bathroom mirror for 2 days. Like this is for you.
But the mirror is on the ground.
The mirror is on the ground. And
so it's all taint. But I can appreciate subtle transitions and subtle movement, but it should be minor and just add to it at like a nice little seasoning at the end. It shouldn't take over. Shouldn't over flavor everything.
No. It's like cilantro. Just like a dash too much and you've destroyed your delicious meal.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe not.
No.
You can always dial it back with salsa.
Hey, we had burritos tonight.
So should we go through the trends and then talk about our predictions if you have any?
Yeah, mine will be wrong. It'll be like I predict my trend will be I will make more logos for people and whatever. Like
so I can probably speak to all of these more than. So let's go through it. Did they get, hold on. Okay. I was hoping there was more detail than that list.
Yeah. Graphic, where, how long are you now? You're too
long. Oh, we can just go through the actual list. So number one, 3D depth and realism.
Oh no. So this is on Graphic Mama. I've never heard of this before, but they had the best looking article with this shit on it. Yeah. So if you go to worstdesignshow.com, click on episode 25. We don't know what it's called yet, 'cause we haven't said what the thing yet that we're going to name it. And you can read along with us. So please take it away.
So number one, this article says 3D depth and realism. Well, 3D is depth. So essentially what I take it as, it's the replacement of the 2D characters.
And
replacing them with 3D. What's I semi agree with this because there's been advancements in like before to create a 3D scene. And a model and all these fun stuff. You needed either a normal PC or a powerful Mac.
Yeah.
But there's actually a few web-based ones that are out there now.
Okay.
One is Adobe something something.
Oh, that's pretty cool.
And the other is Vectoreasy or something like that. I can't remember. Or Vectory. And it's basically like a 3D tool in your Chrome browser. And then you can, then they have a plugin that you can drop your shit onto Figma with whatever you've wrapped. So you had like a beer can, you could wrap it in the label and drop it in your designs.
Yeah.
Without knowing how to build this stuff. Because you can like download and purchase 3D models that somebody else have made and then just add your textures and labeling stuff. So I semi agree with this. It's getting easier to add it to a site.
Yeah, because it's always been such like a drag on like load and it's just unpredictable. Like in the past, like especially on mobile, it can just get hung up like outside of an app. Like within an app, you have your closed loop that you're working in. But any like web-based stuff, usually it's like one person tries it and everyone's like, it's amazing. But it's just like it's tough to use.
Where this gets tricky is implementing it. Anything more complex, you need some really talented developers.
Yeah. But like this example here, they have on a newer iPhone, they have an example of the Fender website or app or something like that. And it's just like you swipe up and there's like a 3D model of the guitar and you swipe up and the whole guitar kind of like falls back and the panel comes up. Like that's pretty slick. It would work just as fine if they didn't do it, but it's cool that they did.
The other problem with some of these is that they show them as an app basically and not a website. And so to add that to a website, it's going to be much more difficult.
Yeah. Especially considering the prevalence of like,
it just ends up
mobile browsing. It's like,
well, you're just relying ends up being on a video.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Not interactive.
Yeah. And sometimes you can create 3D models from it, but it's even more. It's tougher still with you know, I looked at it for a while to get into it and I just, my skill level was dog shit to start it. Yeah, it takes some real developer talent to do that sort of stuff.
Well,
moving on. That one, semi-agree.
Depth and realism. I haven't seen it. Well, I've seen it a bit. Like these characters at the top kind of remind me of shit on like Wealth Simple and stuff. They kind of had those animations.
Yeah.
Those are pretty cool. But yeah, I mean, I think if more people do cool kind of 3D looking shit, then whatever.
I think with the more common augmented reality stuff from your phone.
Oh yeah.
That stuff's kind of neat. And
that's going to be great for that.
We'll cut into it even further.
Yeah.
Even though I never was going to buy one of those cheese grater Mac towers.
Yeah.
Looking at it in AR, like on the ground is like, oh, that's cool.
when they first, when they first launched the Mac Pro, like on the Apple site, there was like the whole thing where you could actually rotate, like as you scrolled, the whole thing in 3D rotated. And that was really cool.
But they've got a stack of people to make that happen.
And then we were just in the Apple store on the weekend in Vancouver, and I was explaining to my oldest kid, it's like, yeah, when they launched this, they had this cool animation, whatever. Then I was just like looking at it. It's like, it's really not much to look at on a desk. It kind of looks like a garbage can.
Yeah.
And if the website was a real thing, then that would be better.
Yeah.
Number two, going monochrome. My guess is that means one color.
Yeah, this is not really a trend. This is more a style.
It says, we've been seeing a tendency of graphic and web designers using a monochromatic color effect on pictures. So, I mean, the kind of like the single or two color color scheme's been around forever.
Yeah, it's and also Spotify did this for their album covers about 2 years ago, 3 years ago as well.
Yeah. Yeah, so. This has like a, like for you listening, like a lot of the photos are... it's essentially like you convert it to black and white and then you pick your color and kind of give it like this overlay, almost like Instagram-y, where everything's a little brighter, mm-hmm. but fuzzed out and fade. Anyway, it's not a bad look at all. It's never really not been around that I've seen. It's really reminds me like with the geometric shapes and this girl doing a karate kick or whatever she's doing in the top right here. It really reminds me of like 2005 graphic design online. Like there was a lot of like big shapes, and I think because they could, you know, transparent GIFs back then, you could do like big impact stuff, but you could still make it transparent because PNGs didn't work anywhere,
right?
So it's kind of like you made big colorful moves but not a ton of color, and it was kind of lo-fi feeling.
I had designed a portfolio like years ago, and the whole concept of it was not doing a traditional portfolio but making it look like a newspaper.
Yeah.
So when you go to it, it has like whatever the branding is at the top and tells you the date. But then the case studies were articles on like as you read a newspaper, and they were all like monochrome with like a paper texture on it. And at the time I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. And then I keep coming back to him like, oh, I should really finish that because I really like it still.
Yeah.
But nah, I'm too lazy.
Yeah, I'm just every once in a while I update my portfolio of just whatever I'm doing. I like to change it up. It's kind of like you want like a quick project to do at home.
Yeah.
And then you're just like, well, I'm just going to like redo it and it's all fine. So right now it's like lo-fi, weird religious imagery. It's really like the kind of portfolio you put together to not get a job. But I like how it looks, and I haven't seen really anything quite like it before, so I'm just going to keep making it. It's basically just it's turning into a big picture.
Yeah.
And like I'm hand doing all the type and or all like the headings and stuff like that, but I'm just taking like weird religious shit from like all the collections I was showing you before, all the pictures and stuff I have.
Yeah.
And just basically seeing what happens.
The last portfolio I attempted to put together is about 90% text.
Yeah.
And all the same weight and font.
Yeah.
And then it's just full width images. And then I built it. I just used viewport width as a percentage base. And so it just scales.
Beefy.
And then I didn't have to do any responsive stuff because it already worked. It's like, hey, that was an afternoon.
Mazel.
I don't care.
So monochrome, yeah, whatever. It's never not really around.
I know. It's never really gone away either. And to do an entire site in that is very...
That'd be
difficult. So
it would be
bits and pieces.
Heavy. Yeah. Especially just like in the bottom right corner here, they have this website. It's like big deer eyes or big ideas. I have Theo Huxtable disease. It's just like a website header with like a color overlay. Like fucking 80% of websites look like that.
I'm surprised you didn't scoff at the name.
Big ideas.
Yeah.
Am I missing like a pun or something in there?
Well, big ideas. Like, it's like big ideas, but kind of like the deers is kind of British.
Big ideas.
Yeah. Anyways.
You're right. Now I don't like it.
Yeah.
Eat a butt, guys. So shiny metals.
Number three, shiny metals.
I'm kind of glad they put in like physical product stuff as well. Like the shiny metals, all the examples they have are finished. Oh.
Too fast, too furious outside.
Hey, we're family.
Ride or die.
Give that kid a Corona. He's family. So yeah, it's all like finished packaging stuff. And it's nice. But like, when have you not seen people using foil and embossed shit on packaging?
Yeah, I don't think this is a trend.
I think this is something that you do when the client has budget and you want to make something good.
We want it gold leaf. Are you sure about that?
Yeah. We want to screen print all of our individual products with gold leaf.
Now, are they confusing actual metal printing with like a UV print?
No, that looks like a foil. And so like some of these, like this one here, there's one, it's a Lee and Jennifer or something. Is it like a wedding invitation? Fuck, wedding invitation is so fancy now. But that one has like tons of effects. Like there's like the embossed rock portion. It's like crumbling over like a bar of gold thing. And there's like lots going on there. What a lot of foil, like that one kind of, well, that one's like a UV and a foil too. What a lot of places will do when they offer like foil, like whatever color foil you want, the paper is actually foil. And then they print a coat of white over it where the foil doesn't want to appear. So if you get like a business,
easier to do, or?
Yeah. And so then they can do like a, basically a clear coat over top of the silver foil. Cause that's what the base card is. And if you want like a red foil, then they just like do a clear coat of red, like a candy over it.
Interesting.
And then it looks like red foil. But if you see a card and like a business card or something like that, and it's it has foil, but it's not like embossed or it doesn't look fancy, try scraping off all the color around the foil, and you'll probably get right down to the silver shit. And those don't wear very well. Like they, like in a business card box, like if, or like if you carry like 10 around with you, they rub on each other,
right?
And all the color that's printed over top turns to white because they have to put down a base white coat to then put color on top of. So they wear terribly. They take a nice photo, but like practically, like you would have to have like one of those business card holders, but have a little piece of tissue paper between each one, or they're going to fuck each other up.
Well, and the cost to do so is going to add. And the thing, like at the end of the day, it's a business card.
Yeah.
And is a foil going to make or break a client? No, I doubt it. I hope not.
Depending on the business, but.
Unless it's a business card business.
Business card business, and business is business. All right. Typography craze is a trend. Isn't that every year?
Yeah.
Design mama fucking on pills or something, lady.
Decorated with beautiful flowers, geometric shapes and more. Oh, no. This is not a trend. This is all the time.
Yeah. In order to create more innovative and modern compositions, designers are playing with typography big time.
Oh, okay. Here's a trend that is overdone. The large, huge text across the page that's outlined.
Yeah.
In behind the content.
Yeah. Yeah. Or like the image is like interplaying within the type where like it's in front of it and behind it and all that kind of stuff. Like it's just one of those like cheap parlor tricks that it's fine. But for the most part, when I've seen them, it's when people bake the type right into the image because they can't figure out how to design it and code it so it'll just work normally. And so then all of a sudden, like there's a site that is up right now kind of around what we're doing, where I design, and so many of the headings and all that are images because they wanted like a graphic treatment or something to it. And now it's like, now translate it all into French. It's like, fuck, like, that should have all just been plain text because that would have been so much goddamn easier. But no, they have to redo all these images now. So like that kind of stuff for like magazines or whatever, like huge impact kind of like single serving ads. I think it works well, but any kind of cool effect that goes on for pages and pages and pages on a website, for me, it just drowns out the impact because people tend to just like go hog wild because they only redo their site every like 3 years. So you might as well go crazy, but
maxi typography trend. It's just big type.
That everywhere. Designers will split the words into multiple lines.
So that it's harder to read.
But that, I don't know if this is like, so far, like, aside from that first one,
we with
like
started off
the 3D models and all that, like that looked new to me. But everything else has been just, it's feels,
all stuff that people do every year.
Yeah. So Bucharest, like this logo.
Wide extended fonts made a big impact this year.
Yeah, I saw there's a bunch of typefaces out where, like, one's called like Velodrome or something, where like the E is like four times as wide as everything else. And like, I saw that years ago on something like probably Scandinavian-esque or something, because they typically do that kind of shit, right? But when you see too many people doing it, it just makes everything so hard to read, because they think they're being cool, but all they're doing is trying a trick and not executing it well. And I'm seeing a lot of that in this, what is this trend? Typography craze.
Yeah, people are crazy about typography.
Melt the fly.
Yeah, these are apparently, okay, that one on the bottom right, I swear, is from 2 years ago. But either way.
Yeah.
Maybe it just looks like something else. Oh, my God.
Image and text masking.
Well, the first example that they showed there, I would agree with. But the others, no. Those are just bad.
So the first one is a kind of like a paint. Like, someone took a brush and did a big, like, swipe with the brush, and then they, in the background is kind of like a pinky beigey thing, but within the swipe is like photo of a river in Beijing, I think it said. Maybe I just made that up, but yeah, I mean, it's artsy and it's fine, but like the other ones are big blocky type with like masking an image behind it, which I don't know if I've seen that. Like this one over here, 1917 Romanov's End of the Empire. That one looks kind of cool because they have the two, but it's like dimensional. So that, but they only mask the dimensional part. So it's like the front face of the two is a negative space, and that it looks sharp. But it's all these things so far, except for the 3D people, are pretty goddamn easy to do. And I think that is the worst part about trends, is when anybody can do them, then they go everywhere. Like, not everyone's going to be doing that 3D animation stuff because it's tough as shit to do.
Yep.
So that'll be tough to oversaturate the market.
Yeah.
But if you know how to hit Command 7 in Illustrator, then you can do anything that I'm looking at in this image and text masking.
True that.
Double true. Line art, number 6.
No, that's a 2000... Wait, hold on. What does it say? Go back up. It says the trend of outline typography notes, which have been quite...
mastered.
Is now evolving. King? Well, how is it... See, this is where the trend has carried over from 2018. There's a difference to it.
And now evolving into fully illustrated and animated line art patterns and designs.
One of the preferred decoration styles in graphic design trends 2020.
So it's like basic, single line, single color, kind of like this line continues and then it turns into a cloud and then it turns into a guy and then the like a box is opening with a bunch of shit shooting out. And really, stuff like this is so, for me, it's so generic. Like, I can tell this animation at the top must have taken somebody quite a while to do, because it's nice and smooth and like there's lots of little effects, but I have no idea what it's talking about. It could be any app. They're opening a box. It's like location, friends, time, heart rate. Like, all right, that's fucking everything now.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the ubiquity of simple line icons to represent simple concepts has gone so far that people don't use them in a simple way anymore, and then they just lose all meaning. Like Briggs' original Boston cranberry made with real fruit drink, like just generic line icons on it.
Mm-hmm.
And
I don't think this is a trend. I think it's just something that hasn't lost its popularity yet.
Yeah, I think it's, for the most part, an easy thing to achieve.
Mm-hmm.
Like it's fine. Ooh. Like it's not really going to hurt anybody.
Number 7.
Collages of drawings and photos.
Oh, I thought this was going to be something different.
Like something more fun?
So it's mixing Photography with doodles.
There's a guy who has a tie when he holds up a piece of paper.
I really haven't seen this too much at all. And this is their prediction.
Dose, there's a guy who has his hair outlined like a mullet, but it's a photo.
I don't think this is going to take off.
Let's see what they say about it. We've been witnessing a quite interesting and creative trend in graphic design, which reminds us of the drawings we used to make in our notebooks in school, i.e. doodling. Oh, you graphic mama explained the shit out of that to us. Doodling has started as a fun trend. I feel like this person is just hoping all this is true. Like they found some things on Behance they thought were fun, and I just don't know. Like,
or it's all stuff they want to do.
Oh, there's a short video illustrating. I've seen that. It's kind of like so what they're showing is like a reel of an, I forget I got the actor's name. Oh, now I'm gonna go back and
it's
see.
Mahershala Ali.
Yeah, Mahershala Ali. So it's kind of like cut and paste and inserting like hand-drawn stuff all around. I'm like, I think it's a nice look. I think this little video was done well.
It is, but
well.
It's not doodling.
No,
there's a difference between that. So if you scroll down a little bit further, I want to see the other examples. Well, okay, those ones are bad.
So that one is a drawn shirt and pants and real arms and real horrifyingly gross shoes.
Yeah, it's taking a cel-shaded effect.
Yeah.
It's like a scanner darkly.
Yeah.
Effect onto it, which on the site itself they pull off quite well.
Yeah.
But I think the doodling is totally different from the other example.
Yeah, the doodling collages of drawings and photos, I guess, but
it ties into one of my predictions.
4 more years of Trump. That's my only prediction. It's fine. Like I think it could probably be done well. Like there's a few good examples of it here. Like I don't mind this little one with the flip flop, but there's like a drawn lady laying in it, like she's laying at the beach. That's fine.
Yeah.
But for the most part, it's the colors in that one that I like.
And it's not a doodle.
No, it's a like a nice drawing of, but it's vectory stuff, and they have their retro supply company brushes, and they have all their aging effects and stuff, and it works. Number 8, simplified illustrations. Now, the example at the very top does not look simple. There's not a ton to it, but in order to achieve that like level of like quality, it's not a simple thing to do. They have like a fox and a lady, and she's wearing a coat, and they're in the woods, and it's like sniffing your hand, and it's doing all these like cool animations and stuff. Like it's not that simple.
It's not.
It's kind of like the step beyond those like Slack.
This is where the
cartoons.
A client is like, oh, you can just create those illustrations. They're pretty simple, so they shouldn't take you that much time.
You know? Yeah.
Nope. They are not simple.
No. But in this example, and again, if you go to worstdesignshow.com, click on the link, and then go to number 8, simplified illustrations, and it's the video at the top is nice. It's about exploring wildlife, and I think it's kind of smooth.
I like it.
Yep.
But it's not simplified. What were the other examples?
Oh, that's...
Oh, yeah. I have seen... I mean, remote Moscow private tour. I've seen a few sites recently where they just use faceless shapes, and it's off-putting.
It has a very like 90s feel to it. Like I can't quite explain it, but it'd be like the cover of like some indie movie from like 1996. And then basic.
Why wouldn't they say just like for the simplified? The stuff looks like children's illustrations from books. Like,
yeah, which can look cool.
Yeah, but if you're a billion-dollar company, that's not what you'd use.
No, and like the little illustrations, whatever, that places like Dropbox use in their app or on their website, it's like, it's just weird.
Yeah.
Like it adds a little color and a little whatever, and like I think they're done well for what they are, but I'm really genuinely tired of multi-million dollar companies creating shit that looks like it's for kids.
Right.
Like when I get an email from, what's that, Treehouse or something? Is that the online learning thing? I think it's called Treehouse.
It's a frog hand.
So I get emails from them being like, come back to Treehouse. Treehouse loves you. And there's like a cartoon of like two trees hugging or something in the email.
Right.
It's like, I'm not a fucking baby. Like, you send shit like that to me, I unsubscribe right away. Because it's not, like, this isn't like an arcade in Tokyo where it's like, yay, fun dancing and crazy animals and all that shit. Like, don't tell me in a form email that you love me and then show me cartoons of trees hugging. Like, I don't care. That's stupid.
That's where departments are separated.
Yeah.
And somebody's just going, yeah, I'll run with it.
Yeah. It's just so disingenuous.
The one on the left, I don't know where it's from, but it could easily come across as like a Headspace.
Yeah. There's a guy meditating, kind of floating a ball above his head and it's like, yeah,
controlling a ball of yarn.
But like Headspace is a great example of like their little videos between like the lessons and stuff. Like they're done well. They're short. They are cartoony, but I don't mind them because they're short. And the rest of the app isn't overly cartoony.
But it'd be weird if there were videos of things.
It would be. Yeah. That's true. If I saw actual videos of people meditating in their lessons, yeah, I'd be like, that guy looks like a child molester and she probably has like 12 McDonald's bags in her car that have been rotting there. Like you start, I wonder if that is part of it. You start passing judgment on people when you see a photo of them. I wonder if he's like a representation of a person if you don't start casting these assumptions upon them.
I don't know if that's true or not. Maybe you do.
Because everyone kind of looks like someone. Be like, oh, it looks like my uncle or it looks like that person from that show or whatever. But if it's, yeah, I don't know. Maybe I'm just thinking about it way more than these other people have. The next one, number 9, fucking isometric illustrations. No, I thought these were done.
That was 2018.
And 17 and all the way back to 12, 10?
Yeah, we can just skim over this one because this is, I completely disagree with this. This is dumb.
They are a preferred style because of their capability to illustrate a three-dimensional object on a two-dimensional surface.
So the first item in this list was 3D.
Yeah.
And now they're saying, oh, and also
flat 2D.
3D illustrations are going to be a thing. You can't have it both.
The isometric thing, like, it's fine. It was overused for so long. Like this one down here where it says like Parky McPark face, that's kind of a new little take on it. It's kind of more subtle. But above where it has like the shield and the credit card and the app and the laptop and all this crap, like all that stuff has been like, if you go into Creative Market and type in like isometric illustration, you'll get all this shit for free.
Yeah.
Or for $4 or something like that. Actually, I'm going to type that in right now.
I did a site for somebody or a client at some point and used a bunch of those to show data and computer stuff.
Yeah.
And it worked fine.
Isometric. But
that was 2 years ago or last year.
Yeah. So if you go to anything and type in isometric anything, then you'll get back a whole bunch of like, what is this? Like there's a whole office scene with a bunch of people and desks and everything. It's $12. There, for $12, you can have a whole isometric thing.
Mm-hmm.
But, I was actually genuinely surprised to see that on the list because I thought that was like super played out.
It is.
Back when I was like almost paying attention to trends, that was already not that cool.
Yeah, it's not. It's over.
Yeah, and there's example here, phone, and that's kind of cool, animation and stuff. There's like a store popping out of a phone and all the chairs twirl and everything. But at the same time, it's like, what is it? It's not like if I'm considering opening a coffee shop, like I think they're showing here or going to one, I don't think that's going to make me go to one. Cause again, it looks like it's for kids.
Mm-hmm.
But do you think that's like a limitation of the medium? Like you can't run video for everything. You can't do huge like productions to be like, let's have an actual store, like fly out of the ground or do anything. Like you have to do everything, not on the cheap, but if you start with a computer, you're not going to spend a lot of money as compared to like a real life production. So I wonder if it's just like people that know how to make a picture of a spaceship and make it fly away, but have no idea how to art direct a film shoot or there's not budget. See, now I'm actually thinking.
Sure. But I don't know.
But it's also like, Why does Pixar make those with creatures instead of people? Like,
but at the same time, you could say like, well, showing a rocket launching from a cube is one way.
Yeah.
But is this appropriate for the brand?
Yeah.
And what else can we do? If we really want to use a rocket, let's come up with a unique way to use a rocket.
Oh, there was, I think, a French commercial.
Instead of being so literal.
Oh, I had that last year with a fucking goddamn client that I wasn't in control of. It was somebody else doing it. So I was looking for something. It's going to be hard to find. But the thing I was looking for is a French commercial about like riding public transit, but they use people in green screen suits, like holding actually like these, like almost like a Headspace style creature.
Yeah.
And they had them like with the little puppet, like sticks that move their hands and all that. And they had them like mounted to like their, around their waist. So it was kind of like one of those camera mounts that's kind of like gyroscopic, like it always, like the camera stays perfectly still as you move around.
Weird.
Like it's all these hinges and stuff, but they did it and they like practically walk these creatures onto like the subway and onto like buses to show like the effectiveness of transit or something. But when you watch it, I thought it was done with 3D animation, and then I watched the behind the scenes and there's these French people in green suits walking these things around like the Muppets show. It was red. And I watched it again. It's like that. But see, that's the thing. I watched it the first time. I figured it was a computer.
Mm.
And then the whole article was about how they actually made it. So I kept reading. But I wonder if we see too much of this stuff now where like the practical effects is lost. Like Baby Yoda. Have you been watching Mandalorian?
Only the first episode.
It's really good. I'm enjoying the shit out of it. But like Baby Yoda, Werner Herzog said that they were going to make it CGI. But then they pushed to keep it as a practical like puppet.
Yeah.
And it's a rad little puppet. It looks great. Like it's super well done and it doesn't have to move around a lot because it's like a, you know, Baby Yoda's a baby.
Yeah.
It's not just a clever name. So it works really well. But I thought some scenes were a practical puppet and I thought other ones were 3D animated because it's everywhere now. So it's kind of like, it's almost like not worth doing it practically because nobody will notice.
Yes, they will. Some people do. I appreciate when I know it's practical.
Some people do, and then...
But I also like the mix of the two.
So I've seen stop motion movies that look like Fantastic Mr. Fox, which is awesome. And then you watch like a stop motion style 3D animated something. It's right. Not that different.
Okay, so Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse was that stop-motion style 3D.
Yeah, which
and
was
I
cool.
I really liked it.
Yeah, it looked great.
The direction of it, the style of it, everything was awesome. If it was like claymation or what have you, I still would have liked it.
Yeah.
Because it was just rad. What does this have to do with our original discussion? What was your original statement about the rocket and isometric
illustrations? It was about like doing it digitally versus doing it practically. Like it's easy to map out 45 degree angles in Illustrator and make all these little cubes and make it look like they'll have shadows and all that stuff. Then you brought up the thing we're looking at right now is called Launcher with like 45 R's or whatever's on the end of it because it's an app or whatever it is. But you were saying that that's such a literal representation of the product because it says launch your product like a boss and then it has a rocket launching out of nowhere, not doing anything like a fucking boss. It's just launching. And then I had a client last year that could not get out of their head that whatever it says on the page, the picture has to be that exact thing.
Right.
I was like, no, this is the statement about the feature and this illustration I made, which by hand and all that is like, this is meant to represent the feeling of ease. And they're like, but you mentioned like launch and then you didn't show anything launching like a spaceship. I was like, well, because we said launch. They're like, well, you have to show it. I was like, you don't have to fucking show it. Like, was there any part in Pulp Fiction when Samuel Jackson looked at the camera and he said, well, it's been quite a Pulp Fiction today. Like people can fucking piece it together, man.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just that like
This is a whole I don't even know. I know. This is a larger discussion.
Yeah. Literal versus conceptual.
I get what you're saying. Also, it comes down to budget too.
It does, but when the client or coworker or whatever can't get out of a traditional way of thinking, it's like you said apple, but then you drew like a forest. It's like, yeah. Well, what do you want? They're like, well, just draw an apple tree or just draw an apple. I'm like, but we've already said it. And now we're communicating like, I don't know if it's like going to, now apple is a bad example, but everyone's thinking about this fucking computers and stuff like that. Anyway, you can say one thing and show another thing that support each other. It doesn't have to be a mirror image of each other.
Yes.
Well, we saw that shit. Number 10 on the biggest graphic design trends of 2020, earthy colors, a sense of vintage. I don't think this is ever gone. Like the vintage. No,
and it's also not just colors, it's treatment as well.
Yeah, like at the top they have something for the mill, which is like saw blades kind of moving. I don't get a vintage vibe from this. But whatever.
I think it's trying to mimic a saw bass.
Yeah, I could see that. And then the description is of this earthy colors, a sense of vintage. Everything new is a well-forgotten old. However, it's definitely hard to forget the amazing 50s, and the following trend confirms this. And they have, so one of the examples they have for this are traditional Portuguese, like, chickens, like, you know, like the kitchen chickens that you can get, like they're made out of wood or ceramic and they're painted on like everything Portuguese, but they're considering that a fad from the 50s.
What is this from though? Go click on view source.
It'll be Shumensko, like, beer
from the 50s. Oh, weird.
Shumensko beer. Oh, is it on dribble? Sick work. Great. Cool. Congrats. Thanks for the props, guys. Love the treatment. Holy. Oh, there's one in Russian. But it has a unicorn and a heart. Wow. This is sick. Love the style. But so Shumensko, Carlsberg, Bulgaria. The campaign was launching the new Shumensko Bobichka, the bomb. Bombichka. A product beer and taste with reminiscent of the past. Five animations made in the spirit and character of the beer. This one linked to the national folklore and traditional Bulgarian color palette. The project was done of the creator. Yeah, that's not the 50s. That's just traditional art from a different part of the world. Just because it has a little grain to it doesn't mean they're going retro. It just means they could be keeping it traditional. Mm-hmm. Now, the one to the left of it has like a lady with large gazungas and a big old booty that has, I guess, the tip of a bullet as a head? What is that? What would you say that?
It could be a bomb or a rocket. It's just now plummet power on the drop, fastest dropping.
Jig heads in the universe. I don't like saying that word.
I don't know what that means.
Race to the bottom with OT. Oh, it's like a fishing lure.
Oh, it's a hook.
Oh, a jig. There you go. Turn your swim bait into a wind bait. Yeah, again, this is like the, I have these brushes too, and it's all, oh, you didn't blend it very well there, friend. Yeah, it's just old school. Like again, like this stuff has never gone away.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, it's hard to pull off like this, the person who did these, this like traditional kind of 50s illustration style. I think they pull it off really well. They obviously know what they're doing, but people have been doing retro stuff since it was old.
Yes.
Which was like, it becomes old when the next trend comes along. And then after a little while, people are like, I remember the old times, but I don't know, I guess that's fine. But the other examples are just a lot of like kind of sloppy type and kind of gross, like 70s colors and yeah, I don't know. So
there will always be some sort of retro vintage comeback.
So yeah. It just depends what is the focus of the vintage at that point.
Yes.
Yeah. So what I've been seeing, so we're halfway through this list. What I've seen so far is colors are trendy, 3D is trendy, flat is trendy, new is trendy, old is trendy. So I think they're hitting all corners of the industry, just saying all of this is important.
Patterns and textures.
Number 11, yeah.
We're off the stage for quite a bit when flat design reigned the web. Now we see a rise in the use of patterns and textures, but not necessarily used in the traditional way. I would agree that this is coming back.
Yeah. This one, AWE, that melty one looks like a thing I made a while ago.
The problem is with some of these textures and some of these things that they're suggesting is they can be a resource hog on a website.
Yes. Especially if they're animated, because that's a lot of
gumption. Any sort of static tends to make your fan turn on your computer.
Yeah. Yeah, I had this like crazy, super fine, like half point kind of like TV static image that I found. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to make it the background of my phone, and it crashed the settings app. It was like, I tried to load it 3 times, and every time it loaded it just as a flat black image. It wouldn't show the pattern. And then I finally got it to stick, and then the whole thing crashed.
Weird.
But I've never had that on an iPhone before, where just like, fuck, this image is too much, man. I can't deal with it. And I have to go lay down. I've had too much Southern comfort and I have to sleep.
So I agree with this one, patterns and textures.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one else. Yeah. There's a goose. There's a lady. What more do you need? Patterns and textures. 12, geometric designs. Now this is kind of a...
What?
It's like a big face made of just kind of basic shapes in Illustrator. Like, it's definitely a style. Like, it really, it's almost like Great Gatsby-esque, kind of that style of illustration, where it's like there's a lot of shading, a lot of kind of like abstract shapes. It's okay. That weird halftone overlay on this one, in particular of a guy's face, is weird.
I don't like how his eyes are showing above his... eyelids.
Yeah, most people don't have that feature. Mm-hmm. Normally it's tucked just, right up in there.
Just a little peekaboo of the iris.
A peekaboo, you do.
So this is not a trend.
No, what is this?
Disagree.
Geometric designs, yeah.
They're basically saying like simple shapes.
Yeah,
which is going to explain everything.
Which, since people have jumped on using like Illustrator and then jumped on using tools like Sketch and Figma... Especially like Sketch when it was earlier, like earlier versions, I found shape creation and like creating like intricate vector graphics to be a goddamn nightmare. And I feel, and I actually know some people that are like 20, like early 20s, mid 20s that are designing that do everything in like Sketch or Figma. And it's all such like rudimentary looking shit. And like, oh, I don't use Illustrator. It's just too much. I was like, but you can make better stuff.
Yeah.
You can make it all snap to pixel. You can make it all uniform. You can make it so you don't like it fits perfectly into what you're doing, but you just have to do it in a different window.
Yeah.
But they do not do that. So, geometry is a trend. So if you like squares, fucking, you're going to have a great year. Ugh, liquids.
Number 13, liquids.
Oh, it's all these big, like,
so.
Goopy blobs on websites.
This site is really trying to cover everything.
Yeah.
Like we said, it's like, okay, simple shapes, but now the opposite, liquids.
Yeah, it's almost like...
That's also going to be a trend.
It's almost like Graphic Mama would go into the grocery store and say, these are the top foods for 2020, and then read every single thing on the shelf.
So, it's basically... like a blobulous shapes.
Quite blobulous.
Semi-transparency, bright colors and color gradients, animations, etc. Let's see the other examples that they provided. It's just, no, it's not. That's not liquid. First of all, those are
blobs.
Oils.
Yeah, that's super, that's like the pearlescent, what dickheads painted their Camaros or their Trans Ams in like the late 90s.
And this trend is already happening right now and will not continue.
No.
Well, it'll still be there, but it's not. I'm having a hard time deciphering between these as trends and styles.
Yes. These, a lot of them are just like one-off graphic treatments and less of like, I haven't seen anything comprehensive, like, and this is how, like, maybe that's a flaw in how they're presenting it. Like, and this is how this brand uses this, from their branding to their print to their like basic collateral to the website to marketing, like to show how it works, or like even like a commercial or something. Just like snapshots just make it, doesn't really get it across.
You could say that like gradients have been a trend this year in logos or in brands.
Yeah.
That was a trend. That wasn't just a style.
Yes.
That is a difference between liquids and geometric shapes.
Let's see, where is design?
Currently, Matt is looking for a file on his Finder.
Well, because I did...
taking over the whole screen.
Oh, it's the one I'm actually looking at. It's over here. It was like a design I did last year for... or a year before for a company, and I used like... It was for, and because I am a hoe for the money, it was for an oil company, and I wanted something basic and all that, and I use that because oil is gradient-y and blobby when the light hits it. So I tried to make oil look nice, because, you know, when it spills and it covers all the ducts, it looks really cool. And yeah, so take that, 2020. I did that in 2018, and I thought it was fine.
Did you find it, though?
Yeah, just the basic, like, the final files are on Dropbox.
Oh.
Like, I don't have them synced. They're, like, cloud synced, so they're not on my machine.
All right, what is number 14? That's it.
To conclude, isn't it 20? 20 graphic design trends. Oh, no, that's 20. See? They wrote 2020, but it looks like 20 graphic design trends.
Mm. For 2K20, but there's only 13.
And yeah, I don't know. You got some shit to share.
Oh, I see. So there's actually web design trends 2020.
Yeah, and the logo design trends. I thought after the break, we could watch the video of logo design trends.
Sure.
By Graphic Mama.
So
awesome Instagram links, web design trends. All right.
How many are in those, in the web design ones?
Enough where we can fly through them pretty quick, because so I don't know anything about websites anymore.
Collaboration of photos and illustrations.
Hey.
That is the other one that they covered.
It's the exact same image they used in the previous one, yeah. Too.
Okay.
Patterns. Hey, fucking like the other one.
Uh-huh.
Black and white, evergreen web design.
Nope, that's old.
That is... Hey, there's the staggered images and stuff that you were mentioning. Minimalist sites with maxi typography. Is yep. that a sentence? Isn't that what it's been forever?
Yes.
All right. Number 5, retro style. That you covered that earlier. Line art. Yep, you covered that. Number 7, illustrations to combine art and... Illustrations to combine art and design. You getting a Jerry King vibe off that one too?
Yep.
For social media? Like that, this Indonesia screenshot, that looks cool. I like that. But
the one below it is not cool.
No, it is not cool. Meet our team. If you have a meet our team thing and you have like artfully done portraits or something like that, or like etchings of your staff, just give it up. Like, you like it more than everybody else does. So think of something else, because nobody cares. But so illustrations to combine art and design. At what point, when, because all these examples are obviously for websites, it's web design trends for 2020. At what point is any of this art, and at what point is any of it design? Is our meet our team page art?
I hope not.
I'm guessing these people got paid never. To design all of this shit. And if you design stuff that looks artsy, like stuff that you don't just make an Illustrator or Photoshop, like uncanned shit. A lot of people are like, oh, like that's a piece of art. It's like, no, I just drew the design. I didn't computer the design. Art is stuff that I do on my own for fun that nobody sees because who gives a shit? It's just for me. But the merging of art and design, I always have a problem with that.
I think there's digital art.
There is digital art, but if there's a difference between getting commissioned for a piece of digital art and getting paid to do a design for a website.
Yes.
Yeah, so.
Number 8, 3D elements and motion effects that impress. Yeah, they're really interesting, but once again, it's mostly for yourself and it's not for the amount of mobile traffic.
So we're checking out dogstudio.co. They're one of the examples, and oh, that's pretty cool. Like, it's like a floating wolf that as you move your mouse around, it all wiggles and stuff. The dog's like blinking and ear wiggling. What if I click you? Can I touch your wang?
There's audio as well.
Nope. Whoa, when you scroll. Whoa. Okay, but now I'm on board with this one. Go to dogstudio.co and just start scrolling.
But here's the thing. On your phone, it's just an image and doesn't do shit all.
Yeah.
Because this is obviously a large bandwidth suck.
Oh, yeah. This is...
And a CPU suck, so...
The only thing sucking about it is resource. I think it was done very well. But see, that's the thing. I haven't read anything. I just watched the dog yeah, rotate. Exactly. And I'm like, okay, I'm done. And then I want to leave. I don't... Like, I assume they're good at what they do because they made that.
That's okay.
But... We just... Well, we're just making good shit like it's 1990. All right.
You sure you want to read...
I'm really not into it. But they see what I said earlier, like once you make a big move on your website, like this floating wolf, and you use it everywhere, it just stops being effective.
Mm-hmm.
Like, just don't have other pages. Just have like the big wolf page. But I gotta say, this one, the type's nice, the everything's nice about it. But it's yeah, you're right, on mobile where most people are gonna see it, they don't see shit.
Time after time, every client I work with, mobile traffic trumps everything else.
Yeah.
So don't bother.
Yeah. It's a dying art. Static 3D graphics. Again, kind of like the Wealth Simple, kind of that matte finish 3D graphic thing that there's another isometric thing.
It's combining. Combining.
And all. Innovations that will be on top of website design in 2020, chatbots, voice user interface and automated assistance.
Yeah, we'll see about that.
Like, I like using intercom. I think intercom's a nice system. I've used it. I designed, mapped out, designed a website for a university. And then I integrated intercom with it and I pre-programmed it because you can make it like, ask a question. It's like, what do you want to know about? It's like, I want to know about admissions, or do you want to know how to get here, whatever. And you click one and it brings you to a new answer. And yeah. then it gets to a point where it's like, hey, looks like we've reached the end of the road here. Like, if you haven't found what you're looking for, then try these pages or contact us. Like, in a very real way, I felt that little function in the bottom right corner of the site was more useful than the entire site.
It can be annoying though when you just get to a site and it pops yeah. up and asks, do you have any questions?
Oh, the way I had it, it was just the little icon, the intercom icon.
Right.
It was just a little, I think it matched it red to match the branding and it just hung out. It didn't pop up like, hey,
right.
if you need help, blah, blah, blah. Because I had a conversation. I was like, is there a realistic expectation that anybody's going to be manning this bot? Like, will anybody be replying to people? Like, well, maybe we'll see how it goes. I'm like, okay, automatically that's a no.
Mm-hmm.
That's like a, we want a blog. It's like, are you going to write in it? Like, yeah, we would like to. It doesn't mean you're going to, it just means you know, aspirational feature. You're not going to do it. So then I just pre-programmed it with all the answers
mm-hmm.
and then directed people to other areas. And they're like, so that's what it does. Like, do we have to go on it? I was like, nope, just let people answer their own questions on every page.
Yeah.
And then that's it.
It works.
Yeah, it's better than a human, because in this case, because the human, especially with like admissions and registration to schools, like there's so many different factors. You could get different information from different people. So what it is like with the bot, you make it say accurate information up to a point where it can't solve your problem anymore because it's too complex, and say, now get on the phone and talk to us. But if you've been helped thus far, if you've self-served, then great.
Yeah.
Go buy a course or do whatever. But Graphic Mama, you put a lot of time into this and you seem to enjoy it, but whatever.
So I'm going to run through my short little list.
Oh, please. Before the break. Please.
So my predictions for 2020 are, well, some of these will match up actually. And I wrote them before I saw these.
Hey.
Texture, rips, and other analog styles are going to come back.
Grip and rip it?
Exactly.
Hey, I just made something with a bunch of rips because I wanted to make it.
Yeah. Clean, minimal will become boring.
Yeah.
The average website, and people will want more.
Clean, minimal.
It has its purpose, for sure.
It's hard to do. Like, for me, a mastery of type and interaction can sell minimal. It can be beautiful. But minimal, it can just get fucking, like, soulless.
Yeah.
Like, if you don't know how to do it, then don't do it. Like me.
Neon lighting is going to make a strong comeback. And I don't mean that in the web design. I just mean in general.
I wouldn't mind that.
I think neon's going to make a comeback.
Actually, the hotel we just stayed at in Vancouver, it's called the Riviera, which is a beautifully old, pretty shitty hotel. But it was cheap. And it was right downtown. And the best part of it was the room was right above their super old school giant neon sign.
Nice.
So all night, the whole room glowed blue, like, which was delightful.
Like Kenny's.
And Kenny Rogers Roasters.
Yeah.
I'm freaking out.
The current design tools. So most design tools, Figma, Sketch, and such, are very square-based.
Yeah.
And I think that they're going to start to adapt to analog more.
Yeah.
So mixing a bit of Photoshop into it.
Yeah, things got, like, especially with Sketch and all that, when I was saying, like, the younger folks who got into it never had to make anything cool in Photoshop before.
Yeah.
And then it all felt very drab. When I use Photoshop, it's to make a cool thing. Like, I know if it's for like a web design or for like an advertising or something, if I'm in Photoshop, I'm hand making something that I can't make in anything else. And that'd be nice to see.
This is a random one. Usability lawsuits will still be ongoing as there's no clear decision.
What do you mean?
So, there's a class action lawsuit against Domino's in the States. And a number of sites and companies have been sued by a small group of blind lawyers.
Oh, for accessibility?
Usability and accessibility. And Domino's, they tried to say that to update their site to do something, or app or whatever it was going to cost them millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And that they weren't going to do it. And so it's now in this kind of limbo of there's no set rules. And I'm really curious about where it's going to go, because to make something like that legal, where you have to make it legal in the States or wherever, could change everything. And where does it stop?
Well, I've designed, I wonder if you have too, designed websites for kind of like front facing like restaurants or whatever in the States. And there is it has to be ADA compliant, the Americans with Disabilities Act. Mm. So you have to achieve a certain like accessibility score. And there's these really great, really comprehensive testing tools where it can go into your site in development and give you a grade and break down exactly what's wrong with it. So there is a certain amount of due diligence that American companies, based on my experience, this may have changed or I may have had slightly incorrect information, but there is a certain amount of due diligence a company has to have on their website to make it ADA compliant. I've never encountered that in Canada. Have you?
No.
Because we don't care about the disabled. Because we're heartless monsters.
But
Robin Thicke.
But the ADA also doesn't have clear language about websites because it was written.
Yeah, by a blind guy. Oh,
it was written at a time when, like, even further backward, it didn't make a difference. Like,
yeah,
the language of websites and apps weren't in there. Maybe websites, but apps.
It'd be really hard to make an app compliant.
But, like, here's what I'm saying is, and I don't mean to single the blind people out, but where does it stop?
Yeah, when's enough blind people?
Like, just
get cool glasses and sticks.
Like, where? Like, would you sue a game company for not making it accessible to the blind?
See, that's the thing. Where when I was making the site for the restaurant in the States, is like, well, we have to be. We're open to all people, so everybody. Like, they have to be wheelchair accessible. They have to have all these things in place too, so anybody can come to their store and eat. Mm-hmm. But with a game, it's like, well, it's a visual game. Like, there's sure. No alternative.
Right. But if you're ordering a pizza online, that's not an essential service.
Yeah.
Where, like, government information, like public service or public information is an essential service that you would have to be.
Yeah.
Compliant. But it's your choice to order from Domino's or whatever. It's not something you have to do. So why do they have to be compliant?
But you could also call.
You could.
So, but also, like.
But here's where I think it's going to change is that I think that we should, that I've mentioned this before. I don't know. But I also think that websites are going to change completely to that. There's not really much of a website at a certain point. So if you were a blind person and you needed groceries, would you go to the site?
I would scream for help.
Until somebody answered the call. You wouldn't go to the site. Well, maybe you do right now. Go to the site, have a screen reader, go through it, and then you kind of fight your way through it. That's where I think it should get into more of the device voice stuff, where it's like,
yeah, Siri,
open save on foods directory or grocery store directory. I would like to order bananas.
Yeah.
Whatever.
But that's like what Alexa does, isn't it?
Yeah, but only from Amazon though.
But they deliver groceries and stuff now too, I believe.
They do in some areas of the States.
But that's also assuming you can afford an Alexa and have a credit card that can be billed like a motherfucker and then you pay it off. Where even for, you know, what I call normies, not everybody has that ability.
Yeah.
So it's like an elite solution to just a basic problem.
So that's why I think there won't be a resolution within the next year and we'll still be figuring it out.
Well, so screen readers, that's one thing. I mean, that can help a lot on like using a traditional website, but when it gets to an app,
there's no screen reader.
Yeah. There's no like, how does a screen reader go into the app and be like radio button?
It doesn't.
Because you can't do that.
Because on the screen reader, it reads like headings and links and things like that, but it's not written the same way as an app.
And plus, it also reads like the tab index you establish in the head and in the body. It's like hit tab once and you go to search, tab twice, go whatever.
Exactly.
But for an app, that there's no tab. Because it's all hand stuff because it is a visual deal.
And plus, an app could be written in Swift or could be written in React. Mm-hmm. And they're both
Chinese. That's how Australian people say it on that Bondi Beach show on Netflix. Every time that there's someone from China or who they think is from China, they're caught in the rip. They go, there's a Chinese lady in the rip. But they say it so aggressively, but that's just how the accent says it.
So it almost sounds like it's a derogatory.
Yeah, it's like she's Chinese. It's like, okay, but you're saving her and you seem to like her. That's just how you say it. So we were watching, it was like Bondi Rescue, I think it is.
Okay.
We watched it all on Netflix because it's great. And then one night, my lady and I, we called our friends in Australia and we're like, say Chinese or like Chinese. Everyone does it. Like, do you not like them? They're like, what do you mean? Like, no, I have nothing, like, I like Chinese people. Like, you guys all just say it's super mean. And then they said it to each other. And they said, oh, no, we do say it mean.
It's got a hard ch on it.
It's a choy. So, shout out to the Chinese and the Australians.
There we go.
Sorry, what were you saying?
I think I was saying, let's go for break and then come back and watch that video.
And if it's from Graphic Mama, which it is, it'll be brief and highly accurate. So until we come back, sit quietly, think about your life, and think about if it's worth pursuing further, or maybe you'd like to end it now. Seasonal depression.
Be up here, okay? You're down here, right? He's on top. He's asking you the questions. And then all of a sudden the interview starts. He asks some questions, you answer some questions, and then you start asking him the questions and you flip it.
Now he's trying to impress you.
Turn that shit around on him.
Turn it around on him.
Topsy-turvy, that motherfucker.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Why you got no credit cards? You got no credit cards at all? Why you don't have a credit card, sir?
You have no credit cards?
Huh? Why do you order these CDs out of those magazines? And you sit next door to the neighbor, and then the UPS guy comes, you pick him up like you live there and shit. Why
you,
is that?
You keep ordering CDs that you don't pay for?
I'm just saying. Examples. How to turn that shit around on his ass, you know what I mean? Specific shit, though.
I don't know. It might not be such a good idea.
I like to talk about this article's reading times is 3 minutes.
Got it. I was also playing the microphone banjo. 3 minutes. I guess the writing, or we're looking at the design trends 2020. if you just did reader view, oh, this isn't Safari. I like Safari. If you take out all the pictures, that's at most a 3 minute read.
Hmm. Okay, let's watch this.
All right, so
video
design trends. 10 logo design trends to expect in 2020. I haven't watched this. And it is by Graphic Mama. Animated cartoon logos. Fun and playful. Oh, this is just... Oh, now what are you doing? So, it's little birds that are moving around. And black and white logos. An absolute classic that never goes out of style. Black and white logos look stylish and seamlessly fit into every design. Okay, so immediately right there. If you're not preparing your whole branding package with black and white versions of the logos too, because I just wrote a 40-page brand manual and laid it all out and did all the fucking name the company, did all the fucking work for it. I include a page for applications of black and white logos in it. Say, in case of emergency, use black and white logo because it looks good with everything. But don't use black and white logos ahead of the color ones because you want people to remember your brand, your color. I pick colors based on research, like where there's a hole in the market. Like, hey, nobody's using yellow in your market for some reason. Is there a negative connotation to yellow? They're like, no, it's fine. It's like people just don't use it. It's like, is it appropriate for us? And if it is and it's cool, then you adopt something that nobody sees. Then you go through all that trouble to then be like, no, it's a black and white logo that anybody can make. Creative letter logos. Mm-hmm. All right, so they're considering that article that's been going around for like 5 years, like, or 10 years. Can you see the hidden pictures in this logo? Like the FedEx logo has an arrow and stuff in it.
Right.
So they're just having logos like that.
Wait, what?
You never seen that?
Yeah, I have.
We kid around here. Free show. Speaking of, there's an R with an arrow in it. Creative letter. Simple geometric shapes. I guess so. Squares, circles, lines, dots, curves. These logos are simple and bold at the same time and carry a super powerful symbolism. Can you carry a symbolism?
I do not ever want to see another logo or brand with a smile face in it.
It's Amazon's now, y'all. Back off. It is very unlikely that that project will make that, or that product will make somebody happy. Like Amazon. Gradient logos. Whoa. And of course they're using Instagram colors because according to the internet, Instagram was the first gradient logo. Retro, oh God, retro logos. So, for anybody out there who wants to make something retro, it doesn't begin and end with finding some retro typeface on like myfonts.com. Like, if you're actually wanting to make something look like it's from, say, the 60s, first of all, the planet's a big motherfucker. The 60s existed on the whole thing at the same time, but nothing looked the same. So find the era, find the region, find the vibe that you're looking for, and then see what's making that unique. Often it's imagery, it's colors, sometimes it's type, but really like dig into that era and find like mood boards can work and they can't, but in cases like this, they really can, in that what's the like unifying bond all this shit has from that era that makes it distinctly that era? Then just start writing stuff down, like muted colors, like there's grain to it. There's like, or it's like very simple, or it's hand done, or it's very type focused. And it, like doing something from the 60s from like Orlando versus doing something from Helsinki, you're going to get fucking wildly different results. So yes. It's not a font.
I am a big proprietor of retro future.
Proponent?
Yep. That's the one. And that is old movies of the future.
Yeah.
All their shit.
Yeah. That's like Blade Runner-y stuff like
Blade
that.
Blade Runner, Aliens.
Like, yeah.
I love it.
Cybertruck.
All. Yeah.
And Cybertruck is a great example of that shit because it, if, what is the name?
It's a great example of
Ripley. What's the
analog.
Alien lady? Ripley? Wrigley?
Ripley. Oh my, yes, Ripley.
Ripley? Believe it or not, I didn't know that. Hey, fun jokes for everybody. If she like got out of her exosuit and climbed into that thing, it would not have looked out of place. They would have been like, fuck yeah, she's a truck.
It would have to have six wheels, but yeah.
Yeah. Go Grickly. So retro logos. I think having a cat with a handlebar mustache is retro.
That's not a retro logo.
Metal engraved logos.
Nope, that's not.
That's terrible. But that's not. But that's print stuff. That goes back to their foil metallic shit. Like, if the client can afford it, you can do it. If it's appropriate. Custom fonts and logo. Whoa! Custom fonts and logo typefaces. This one for Colossus Processing. Is this like a meat processing? Because it looks like a fucked up like slaughterhouse logo.
The other, to add to this, I also think that there's going to be more type next year that's representative or looks like handwriting, like the Antihero Nar Hunters page.
Yeah.
But it'll actually be type because instead of doing an image, it'll start to be like, okay, how can we figure out how to do this so we can change it and style it via code? That's what will happen.
But the problem with that is always, especially on the web, is that like the handwritten E as a font, if you have like with the word tree, it's super obvious that it's just a font.
Right. So that's where you have alternate characters as part of it.
But so with alternate characters, some typefaces instinctively will like adjust, like show like fancy ligatures or whatever it is, depending on what you write.
Yeah.
But does the browser render it like that? Like if you have like an F and then an E or whatever, would it make like the fancy F that connects?
I don't have an answer.
Because that's where it falls apart, is if it's all manual, then it's fucked. Because what are you, like, applying spans to the second E? But you could do, like, I think you could, like, inspect it for, like, doubled up and then just automatically apply it. But, like, I wouldn't mind more hand-done stuff, like, just to take you out of the fact that you're, everything you look at is a fucking rectangle, that all the typefaces look the same, essentially. Everything is just kind of has the same computery wash to it. But, like, the anti-hero ads, since the beginning, I think Julian Stranger does some of them, if not all of them, the owner of the company. Yeah, he handwrites all the shit on it, and it looks cool.
Go to... Okay, actually, you know what? I'll wait till this is done.
All right. And then... Damn. So none of this is any different than any other shit.
Yeah.
3D logos. Logos with shading. Isometric logos.
Shapes and logos?
Semi-transparent.
Oh. No.
Boom. A cool effect with an essential meaning. What the hell does that mean? Graphic Mama. This episode is accidentally not brought to you by Graphic Mama because this lady has lost her goddamn mind.
So, shut this off.
Hold on. I'm almost done dancing.
The music is...
infectious. I like how it just cuts off, too. It doesn't... It fades down for 30 seconds and it just... bloop, right off the cliff.
So go to philkaufman.com and that's P-H-I-L... And then C-O-F-F. I know.
He's a cough man. Like it is. Ooh, mama life.
So, everything here is editable. It's not images. So if you go, if you scroll down, for example, into another blog post that he's written. So that's all actual type.
So let's see. Yeah, there's the dreaded double.
Yes.
But it's not that obvious. Like when it's, yeah.
But even the, so I inspected how he did the headings with the texture because it is text.
But you can just mask.
Yeah. So that's just using stuff behind it. But yeah. I really like this site for its kind of merging of the two, like new and old.
Well, this looks like stuff that I used to make when I started making stuff. It was just like make everything look like old papery, hand done.
But it's not overdone.
No, that's the thing is that it's really easy to go like hog wild. But you do have to keep in mind that this stuff has to be readable, usable or whatever if it's a functional piece.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, a little goes a long way with stuff like this, but it's really cool. So if you're listening, go to worstdesignshow.com and check out this link at philkaufman.com.
Yeah.
It's lovely work. Ooh, Doppler effect. That's a cool graphic. It's kind of like a concentric circle, but it actually genuinely looks like a hole in the ground going down. Ooh, mama think this crazy. Oh, this is very nice.
Mm-hmm.
Well, God damn it, Phil. We love you and everyone loves you. Yeah, I'll check this out later and that'll be nice for me. That it?
That's it.
All right.
We're done.
That's it. We're done. Marcus is done. Episode 25 done. If you've been listening to every one of these since the beginning, you are a weirdo, but we appreciate you. If you're listening recently, then...
We appreciate you, but not as much.
No, less. We will always appreciate you less. Unless you email us at designersaretheworst@gmail.com. I've guaranteed, as I said, I've assured this address works. We've given it out probably 10 times on the show, not one email.
Yeah.
I'm going to check it again when I get home to make sure it works. But designersaretheworst@gmail.com or at Worst Design Show on Instagram and Twitter. You can. We're also on SoundCloud, Stitcher. What's another thing? Spotify, YouTube, Apple Podcast, all of the things. But if you're listening to this, that means you found one of them, and you are ahead of the game.
You use the Apple Apple Podcasts search to actually search for transcribed material.
Oh, really?
I've looked and I couldn't find anything of ours.
That's fair.
But it apparently like scrapes the audio and is you're able to search by text of things that people said.
Oh, I remember that from earlier in the year. They're making it like,
yeah,
it's like a contextual search, which is pretty gnarly.
I don't know if how it works or if it's even in motion, but
that'll be interesting because good luck, everybody.
Yeah.
Just look up cat dicks or something. You'll find us for sure. Worst Design Show at Worst Design Show on social media stuff. Marcus can be found circling the parking lot at Costco most nights. Driving backwards, just working on those J turns. Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed the show, then that's interesting and we appreciate it. And we'll be back in a few weeks. Remember, making pictures for a living ain't that bad. And if you think it is, then you are diverse. And that's a German sausage joke.
You got long ass balls.
I've got long balls.
Doctor, you seen his balls, right?
Would you say my balls were unusually long?
They're a bit more distended than the average testicles.
You got long ass balls, Larry. Long ball Larry. That's your new name.